560 WQAM presents the Neil Rogers Show. Talk to Neil.
Now 567 Road 560 in Dayton, Maryland County. Call 560 for Verizon Wireless customers.
877-785-NEIL is a toll-free call. The opinions expressed by Neil Rogers, his guests or callers, does not reflect those of the Beasley Broadcast Group, its staff, advertisers, or agency. Now, the Neil Rogers Show on 560 QAM.
I am juiced up right now.
To break into your aunt's house?
I didn't break in.
Your picks are locked?
Yes.
Did you have a right to do that?
No, sir.
And you want us to believe you did it because you were worried that her car was there and you were afraid that something happened to her?
I didn't know what was wrong. Her car was there. She's hardly ever home, but she's hardly ever gone without her car.
Wow. So anyway, let me ask you this. Do you feel responsible for that shooting, George? George is back today from Tennessee. Do you feel good? George is responsible.
I loaded the gun for him and everything.
Oh, because I don't. Anybody else in the audience feel responsible for this?
No.
Because Robert Steinbeck, in one of the most pathetic, horrendous columns I've ever read in my life, which I'm going to read the entire thing on the air in a couple of minutes, writes in the Herald this morning, Brazill trial bears our errors. We, society, did it. We're supposed to be responsible for it. Now, Court TV has taken a poll as they're showing the trial that's going on right now. I don't want to deflect a lot of people because it's on CNN. It's all over the place. But it's on Court TV, which is much better to watch there anyway because they don't interrupt it as many times for all those stupid commercials like we do. But anyway, they're taking a poll as the thing is going on, which they've been televising the trial from the beginning. And the question they're asking is, do you believe Nathaniel Brazill's account of the murder? 84% of the people responding say
no.
And only 16% say
yes.
Yeah. 84 to 16% say absolutely positively
no.
No, we don't believe him. Let's give you the poll result from yesterday on our show. Which of these groups most deserves financial reparations? African Americans, this is out of 931 votes. African Americans, 37. 37. I mean, not even 4%. Holocaust survivors, 115, 12.3%. American Indians, now we're talking, 322. Say American Indians.
Indian killer.
Deserve reparations, 34.5%. Was that a little bit loud? How's this?
Indian killer.
How's that?
Better.
Okay. And none of the above, which is what I voted, nobody deserves no reparations, 456. 48.9%.
Oh!
There you go. Almost half of our people got it right. Excellent. The idea that we're supposed to, and that whole concept ties right in with Robert Steinbeck's column in the Herald this morning. It's ludicrous. The idea that we're responsible for stuff that we had nothing to do with, or we're responsible, society as a whole is responsible for anything. Because, first of all, there is no such thing as society as a whole. And the fact that the kid was 13 years old when he committed the murder, and that's exactly what it was, not no accident, when he committed the murder of his teacher. You see, we're supposed to feel very bad about that because society made him whatever he was. We're responsible for it. Now, if he would have waited 5 or 6 years until he was an adult, then we wouldn't have to feel so bad about it. And I keep bringing up Ted Bundy as an example. Isn't Ted Bundy a real good example?
Uh-huh.
I think so. Before I read the whole column, here's a paragraph from Robert Steinbeck's idiotic, dangerous column in the Herald this morning. It really is dangerous. He says, we were told our society was to blame for homelessness, crime, the untreated mentally ill, the abandoned elderly, drug abuse, homophobia, and on. And you know something? He's talking about America, being exhausted by guilt. But as a society, we're responsible for ignoring these problems. But as far as the homophobia, let me speak to it personally. When John Wayne Gacy was caught having killed all those boys and young men, were there any gay leaders or any other gay people defending John Wayne Gacy?
No.
Not that I ever heard of. Was I defending him?
No.
No. Anybody defending Jeffrey Dahmer?
No.
Of his barbaric and grotesque acts? No. So the idea that there's been racism and homophobia and sexism and all these bigoted things, that's not debatable. We all know that. These are part of society's ills that we try to cure, supposedly. But to try to suggest that because the society is responsible for that, individuals no longer have to be responsible for their own actions, and later on in the column he does, you know, respond to that, but in a very mamby-pamby way. But he's a child. Now, if you try to tell me that a 13-year-old kid doesn't know the difference between right and wrong, and that all of his classmates, you'll notice if you've been watching the trial, all of Nathaniel Brazill's classmates, they're all liars. The rest of the world is out of step. He's the one that we are supposed to believe. He'd be telling the truth. And for an honor student, it's interesting that he was about to get an F in English class from Barry Gruno, who's the teacher that he shot. And in your entire column here this morning, Robert Steinbeck, other than mentioning the name of the teacher, I don't read a single word. All these paragraphs, which I'm going to read, I don't read one word in there, not one, about the teacher and the wife he left behind and the family. I don't read anything about that. Bright, young, dedicated teacher, which is pretty damn hard to find these days.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. We're always bellyaching about the schools suck and we can't find good teachers and the pay is too low and all of these things, which are all true. There's not one word about that. See, this is what's wrong with America today. We're not supposed to be interested in the victims anymore. Oh, how could we, you know, what's the point of wasting another life? We had that call a couple days ago. Yeah, what's the point of wasting another life by putting this young man in prison for the rest of his life? And then my response was, well, how about Ted Bundy? Didn't we execute him? Uh-huh. We're not even talking about executing this kid. That's not going to happen.
How can we waste Tim McVeigh's life?
How can we, next a week from today, May 16, we're going to be wasting Tim McVeigh's life. I mean, he's got that nice orange jumpsuit. He could be out here on the corner of 441 and Ives Dairy Road doing the homeless voice thing. He's already dressed for it. He could be raising money for the homeless. He, like I said, he's got the right outfit. Why should we waste his life? Just because he committed those barbaric, grotesque acts and blew up that goddamn building in Oklahoma City. I mean, Robert Steinbeck, you are really a fool. You are pathetic, and you're not fooling anybody. A fool don't fool nobody. Just remember, you heard that first here. Remember that?
Yes.
Write it down. I mean, I'm going to read this, and it's a good thing I don't eat breakfast because I'd probably puke my guts out if I had, you know, if I had a big breakfast this morning. It's not for somebody with a weak stomach because it's so nauseating. And I'm sure that we'll have a few of you folks out there. I don't want to say that, you know, of any particular persuasion, but we'll have a few folks who probably agree with this crap that he wrote in the paper this morning. Maybe some of you already read it, be reading it. And here's our poll question for today, which fits right in. Fits right in. And I made it simple because Eric is on the road today. He's doing an eating a tour of Florida. What? What are you laughing about? He's stopping. No, he's doing it for Consumer Reports. He's checking out all the service plaza rest stops for the food thing. Mrs. Fields Cookies and Nathan's, all of those things. I think he'd be pretty good at that, don't you?
Uh-huh.
That's what Eric's doing. So he's on the road. But he is going to be able to put up our poll question, but he said, make it simple. I said, hey, it's perfect for me. I'm pretty simple. Here's the poll question today on NeilRogers.com. Do you think most Americans take responsibility for their own actions, yes or no? Very simple, and it ties right in with the Nathaniel Brazill shooting of his teacher and with all these bleeding hearts and this wacko. Do you read about this guy who was demonstrating outside the courtroom yesterday that they had to drag off?
No.
This wacko, this Will Vanatta? Yeah, he ran inside and disturbed the trial. Screaming and shouting and carrying on like a banshee.
Like my mother did at the graduation. Oh, I'm sorry.
Like your mother did at the graduation. Birds of a...
All you have to do is wait the 5 days for it, and happiness is just around the corner. Hell, if you don't want to wait the 5 days, who cares? Buy the damn thing off the street. Just buy a lot of handguns. It's a great alternative to working problems out and can be considered a population controller. Yes, handguns. They just might make you famous.
10:14 at 560 WQM. So you got another appearance at Bill Seidel's. Let's start promoting that way ahead of time. Maybe you can get a couple of geeks to show up.
That's not nearly as amazing as the Shell gas station appearance I'm going to be doing this Friday.
All right. Okay. Wow. Now, what's it going to be, free gas or something?
I asked Miguel, what's the idea?
Oh, George is
going to
give you some gas. Yeah.
And there's nothing.
In line with the show that we did on Monday, George is going to be providing with gas, not out of the pump. But at any rate, so it's this Friday?
Yeah, but I don't know which Shell.
From 5 to 7. So just drive around town to all the Shell stations and look for George. It's a gas. And then, of course, you waste enough gas that you'll have to fill up again. It's probably part of the deal, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Anyway, a protester disrupts proceedings. A county lifeguard and perennial protester injected himself into Nathaniel Brazill's first-degree murder trial yesterday morning by loudly assailing a system that's trying the 14-year-old boy as an adult. "This is wrong," shouted Will Van Atta, 45, in front of the jurors before deputies grabbed him and dragged him from the courtroom. "He can't vote. He can't serve on a jury. This is wrong," he was shouting and screaming before they dragged him out. While some legal experts called the incident unfortunate, they doubted that the outburst would affect the trial on charges that he shot teacher Barry Gruno last year. Kurt Gruno, brother of the slain teacher, was so concerned about the possibility of a mistrial and so disgusted with Vanetta's display that he followed him as deputies led him to the front of the courthouse. Gruno tried to lunge at Vanetta, but was restrained by deputies and walked away. How do you like that? Lifeguard. Maybe he knows the fisherman, you think?
Uh-huh.
That's a possibility. Maybe they can elope together. Sounds like a match made in purgatory. And just like Robert Steinbeck, we've got all these activists out there very concerned about this poor little kid. Who, again, watching his performance these last 2 days, to be honest with you, I don't really think all that highly of him, you know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
He's not all that bright, at best. Although he does play a mean tuba, I hear. But nobody cares about the victims anymore. Nobody gives a crap anymore about people who are victimized, about lives that are snuffed out. Because, like I've told you for years, life in America is as cheap as a goddamn chocolate malt. Or, and now what were you saying? You got a good chocolate malt?
Sonic. Good everything.
Yeah.
Good golly.
Okay. So Robert Steinbeck, who probably ought to go to Sonic for one last supper before we, cool him out somewhere. This is a crazy person. Robert Steinbeck at the Herald. He's written some columns over the years that I've agreed with, and I've read those, and yada, yada. But every now and then, his professional darkism comes into play, and that's got to be what this is all about, because he's not a stupid person. And I want you all to prepare, everybody in the audience, prepare to feel very guilty. Are you ready for that?
Uh-huh.
Good. I want you to feel really responsible, just as though somehow you were responsible for preferring to give the kid an F in English class and for not letting the girls out of... See, he was actually going to let him come inside and talk to the two girls when he came back. That wasn't good enough. He wasn't going to let the girls step outside the classroom to speak to Nathaniel, so therefore he pointed that gun. Oh, gee, it went off. Now, they asked him to demonstrate in court. They had him holding the gun. They asked him to demonstrate, and by the way, the prosecutor is doing a great job. Asked him to demonstrate how in holding the gun it could go off accidentally. He couldn't do it. He gave him every opportunity under the sun. How does that happen? Show me. Give us a display. Could he do it?
No.
Huh. But anyway, so get the puke bag ready when you hear this. Robert Steinbeck writes in the Herald this morning, Brazill trial bears our errors.
Yes.
He says, I haven't been able to shake the feeling while following coverage of 14-year-old Nathaniel Brazill's murder trial that society finally is off the hook for what's wrong in society. Not long ago, society, meaning the people of our communities and nation and our collective attitudes and values, would have felt compelled to examine its own role in the boy shooting of teacher Barry Gruno. That's the only time he mentions the name. Young Nathaniel did, after all, spring from our midst. Young Nathaniel. Now, you just listen to the adjectives, see? Young Nathaniel did, after all, spring from our midst. Don't we have an obligation to examine the reality we've created to search the clues to explain why a 13-year-old would react to a minor setback, being sent home from school for misbehaving, by carrying a loaded gun to school and pointing it at the face of a teacher he admired? No longer, it seems. We created this screwed-up, confused, frightened boy just as surely as we've created and proudly taken vicarious credit for the scientists, entrepreneurs, and artists America's produced. But we don't want Nathaniel Brazill on our conscience's balance sheets, so we've cut him loose to bear the murder charge alone. How cowardly! When something good arises from our society, we are America, the proud nation of values. Yet when the same cauldron spews forth something bad, we point an accusing finger at the individual and exonerate ourselves, saying America had nothing to do with it. I hear so little outrage, despair, or even angst that yet another child faces life in prison. No political or civic figures have spoken up except those who endure such barbarity in the name of justice. There's scarcely a debate at all. The bully pulpit is vacant. This subtle but relentless philosophical shift away from society bearing any responsibility for its citizens' actions has intensified during the last quarter century. As I see it, America has been exhausted by guilt. The depression forced society to take responsibility for poverty and economic injustice. The civil rights and feminist movements forced society to admit to generations of institutionalized racism and sexism. The list grew. We were told our society was to blame for homelessness, crime, the untreated mentally ill, the abandoned elderly, drug abuse, homophobia, and on. America made considerable social reforms in the latter part of the 20th century, but rather than this progress being a source of national pride, it morphed into resentment. Overuse of the guilt card by political liberals opened the door for conservatives to stoke this resentment. Progress by distressed segments of society increasingly was depicted as coming at the expense of more deserving and productive segments. Criminally inclined kids became the exclusive fault of parents, not society. I'm not exonerating the individual from self-responsibility for bad behavior. Far from it. Ascribing responsibility to society never removes it from the individual. Nathaniel Brazill must be disciplined for his actions, but not as an adult. The reason he's being prosecuted is one is that we are too cowardly to admit that kids are shaped by the world we created. How do you like that? We're too cowardly. Now, don't you feel bad?
I feel, you're right, very guilty.
Don't you feel guilty and responsible for the fact that we've done things that caused him to do this? In addition to which, let me say you're full of crap, okay? You're full of Schmidt, Robert Steinbeck, because after every one of the kid shootings in the last few years, whether the shootings at Columbine, whether the kids were black as in this case, or white as in that case, or whatever, after every one of those cases, there's been this long gnashing and hand-wringing and carrying on of why do kids do this, and what was in their background that caused them to do it, and were they abused as children, were their parents unfit? There has been no shortage, hours and hours and hours, of why, as a society, we've somehow failed, which has absolutely nothing to do. It's just a smokescreen. It's just a cloud. It's just obfuscation is all it is, to try to cover up for the fact that this kid knew exactly what he was doing, that he's the liar, that his schoolmates, all of whom got up on a witness stand and very articulately told their story and how he said he was going to go back and F up the school. Because he was pissed off and fired up. Because he was caught throwing water balloons in class. And because he wanted his name all over the goddamn newspapers and in the media. Another one of these deals. Are we responsible for that?
No.
A girl suspended along with Brazill said that as they were leaving that afternoon, he said he was going to come back and shoot the guidance counselor who caught them. Classmate, and of course he wasn't around, so he shot the English teacher instead. Classmate Michelle, and of course the English teacher was going to give an F, so he deserved it. Classmate Michelle Cordovez said Brazill warned her that he was going to be all over the news. Brazill said Tuesday he didn't remember the conversation at the time. He said he was mainly mad at himself for doing something that would get him suspended. He also denied asking an 18-year-old neighbor for a gun just after he'd been suspended. Brandon Spann testified last week that he bumped into Brazill, and the seventh grader asked him for a gun that he could take back to school. Brazill said it didn't make sense to ask, for him to ask Spann for a gun. He already had one at home, meaning the one he stole from Grandma, Grandpa. I mean, his answers to the questions are so ludicrous. And of course, they've had a year to cook up this whole deal, him and his lawyers told him to do this, and his lawyers told him to do the interviews with the magazines and elicit all the sympathy he could get so that people like Robert Steinbeck could write this swill, this garbage, this trash in a major market newspaper this morning about how we're cowardly.
I feel horrible.
And it's even especially those of us who think that America is a slaughterhouse and that all these guns being around are and people being irresponsible with the guns. How many times have I talked about that? 80 billion times over the years?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. But I'm supposed to feel responsible and bad. Well, guess what, Robert Steinbeck? I don't feel bad. Because I know the difference between blowing somebody away when I get pissed off. George's mom would be in a box right now if it weren't for the fact that he knows the difference between right and wrong, between blowing somebody away or not, every time they get pissed off. In fact, it would have been years ago.
Well, it would have been right, but it would have been illegal.
Well, there you go. So you see, thank God for George, so he doesn't have to bear responsibility for it any more than I do. I wonder how many of you people in the audience feel guilty for Nathaniel Brazill blowing his teacher away.
I'm changing the way I do everything now.
Yeah. I mean, what crap? Society did it. This individual didn't do it. I mean, talk about contradictions. In one part of the column, he's writing about society has got to examine itself for our attitudes and values and yada, yada, yada. But the interesting part of it is that the overwhelming majority of kids, thank God, out there don't take guns to school, don't shoot their classmates, don't shoot their teachers, don't shoot their friends, don't F up the school. And they're growing up in the same society, watching the same TV. And I should point out, by the way, that Brazill has also testified that he had a pretty good home life. Yeah, he had a good home life, that he was happy with his mother and his stepfather. He was angry at his father, but nevertheless, he was happy with his mother and stepfather he was living with. And he was not happy with his home life. That's usually the excuse. There are no excuses. Don't you understand? Anybody making excuses for Ted Bundy?
No.
Jeffrey Dahmer?
No.
David Berkowitz?
No.
John Wayne Gacy?
No.
Charles Manson?
No.
Richard Speck?
No.
No. Nobody's making excuses. And I should point out that they still don't really know when the first killing was that Bundy did. But if you read the book about Bundy, the ones that they do know, he was still a teenager when he committed his first murders. There you go. So how come we executed him?
Wasn't he scared and confused and troubled?
Oh, and that's right. And they lied to him about who his real mother was or something like that. Remember that?
Yeah.
He was a bastard. Literally. And now he's dead. Anybody feel sorry for the fact that he's dead?
No.
I don't think so, except for the bleeding hearts out there who think that capital punishment is barbaric, like I was saying last week till I came back to Earth. No, but you see, because I thought I still lived in Holland when I was saying that. And then I realized, oh, I live in the U.S., I better be for capital punishment, because this isn't a civilized place like that, where people don't run around blowing each other away. We have more murders in one day here than they have in most other countries in a year. In one day. In a good weekend here in Miami, we can beat like most of Europe in a whole year. Except, of course, for those good religionists in Northern Ireland, things like that don't count. Plus, they use bombs anyway. They're more like the Cubans. They use bombs, you know? La Bamba. Oh, here's Bobby Shapiro on there. I wonder what kind. I'm not going to put it on. I don't want to hear anything he has to say. Next thing, he'll probably be saying O.J. did it. In fact, do we know that if O.J. was at the school that day?
No.
Are we positive?
No.
Well, there you go. Something to think about.
He's a slasher. He uses
maybe O.J. was looking for the killer of Nicole and Ron that day at the school. Maybe he put a bug in Nathaniel's ear, huh? I mean, we don't know for sure. That's my point. I'm not suggesting anything, but we just don't know for sure, do we?
No.
No, he probably has a good alibi. Maybe he was with Pedro Guerrero that day. Or maybe he was getting into some kind of a civil disobedience kind of thing out there in the streets with you. Who knows what the hell he was doing, and who the hell cares? But if anybody out there feels any guilt because Robert Steinbeck told you to be told in us that we ought to feel guilty, then I feel for you. I feel for all of us that we don't have a real newspaper in this town that would write, you know, have columnists who could write more intelligently than that. 26 after 10 at 560 WQM. If you didn't get a good night's sleep last night, here's the answer for it. Here's the remedy for a long time to come. Call Dial-A-Mattress, where you get super low prices every... I don't want to mention his name on it. My close friend in the afternoon there. I'm really...
That was funny.
He comes in here yesterday, Hank, and just back from Louisville. I guess maybe he's still under a lot of stress that he didn't pick the winner any more than the rest of us did. And he's telling me before his show about the... they really got an exciting young team to watch, the Marlins. And I said, you don't understand. Nobody cares. You don't get it, Hank. There is no interest. There is none. And I explained to him that on Sunday, on a beautiful, perfectly sunny day, with no threat of rain, with no great humidity or high temperature, you know, low 80s, they had 10,000 announced and an actual crowd of 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 people there, maybe. So I'm driving home and Hank is going on about, well, you know, really, what a shame it would be to lose the day. See, a lot of you folks, you just didn't deny. You don't understand. I mean, you may have the best reindeer meat in the U.S., but, take it to Finland and sell it. There's no interest in it here. No, seriously. You may have the best halava, but taking it to the North Pole, they don't like it up there. You know, you have to take it somewhere where they're interested in it. There is no interest here. So Bush and Carollo now, and the best part of the new deal is, the rumor is the deal is they're going to make us an offer so good we won't be able to turn it down. Have we heard that before?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Carollo says he hopes to craft a ballot measure. I love the way, do you hear the way that's, he's going to craft a ballot measure. In other words, if you're against the stadium, vote maybe. If you're for it, vote, we don't know, and we'll figure out what you really mean. He hopes to craft a ballot measure that would go before the voters in July. And Bush said he'll ask Senate President John McCain, House Speaker Tom Feeney, to make the plan a priority when legislature meets again in January. January, this is the middle of May. There are even whispers about maybe like a special session, which the governor says is highly unlikely, but don't ever count it out. Carollo says the voters would, in essence, be asked all the questions that are pertinent to a new stadium. It'll be something that will give the Marlins the assurance they need to move forward, whatever that means. In July. Am I going to be here in July?
No.
So don't blame me. I won't be here to lead the bandwagon. I'm sure George will do his part, since he hates sports anyway. But what a joke. And I think it's great. Put it on the ballot. Have a special election. I mean, evidently, the city of Miami that's always on the verge of bankruptcy, they have unlimited funds. All of a sudden, unlimited funds to go and buy the land and do all of these other things. No problem. They're finding money all over the place. City and the county. Same county that can't give textbooks to your school to kids in school to take home. Oh, don't get me started on that again, because then Dave Hyde will start picking on me and saying, oh, there you go again with education, Neil. It's not gonna, getting rid of the Marlins won't save the schools. Right. Well, what a brilliant observation that is. But I'm sure we could probably find something better to spend that $120 million that they wanted from legislature on, not to mention all the other millions and millions and millions of dollars you're going to be subsidizing all these white elephants with for the next many, many years. Will they ever learn here?
No.
No. See, because these are people who, they're like our sales department, the Marlins, and the politicians who are in bed with them. They don't know one word.
No.
They don't know that word. Just like the old Julio Queens, they don't know that word.
No.
They don't know what it means. They just won't stop.
No.
Now, that, what is that?
No.
Okay?
No.
Just this one time, Kay.
No.
They don't get it. So it doesn't make any difference what the public say. They're going to continue hatching and plotting and planning. And I'm really worried in July if that goes on a ballot, because Hank yesterday indicated, what I heard from him tells me again that he's wavering, he's waffling. He's waffling. Now, nobody loves hockey more than I do, but you know something? If they said, if they came, if Wayne came on TV at noon today and said, well, we have found a legal loophole and we're able to break the lease with the Mac Arena because we can't find a new buyer for the hockey team and we're going to move them to Tennessee. Where the hell were you just in town? Give me a, like,
yeah.
Knoxville. They already got Nashville. We're going to move them to Knoxville, Tennessee.
Johnson City.
Johnson City. Batavia, New York. We're going to move the Panthers. Would I shed any tears?
No.
No. I just don't care anymore. I don't care to the point where I stop going. And I, just like with the Marlins, I get my tickets for free. I don't care. I stopped going because, not because they were losing, but because it wasn't entertaining, because it was depressing, because there was nobody there, and for good reason there was nobody there. It was a waste of time. It's a social club. And when you dilute something, and like I talked about the other day, if Ruth Chris started serving hamburger, I think they would lose most of their clientele very fast. And then if they started serving like really low-grade hamburger, I don't think anybody would be going there. And it's the same thing. Oh, yeah, but come back. Our hamburger's better this week. Well, too late. You've already blown it. Too bad. We found other things to do, other things to eat. And it's the same thing with these sports moguls, you know, with all these multi-billionaires. You keep watering it down. You know, we spent out taxpayer dollars. They finagle. They come up with some cockamamie scheme. We build these big, gigantic, beautiful palaces. And then if things don't quite go quite your way, you just, you savage, you trash the organization. You leave us with a shadow of what we had before. And anybody doesn't believe that, if you watch the Buffalo-Pittsburgh series, Game 5, Stu Barnes scores the winning goal for Buffalo in overtime. Game 6 last night, Marty Straka scores the winning goal in overtime for the Penguins. And who are the names we keep hearing during the game last night? Straka and Barnes, and there's Rhett Warner again, and there's Jason Woolley. Scott Mellenby doing great there in St. Louis. They win 4 in a row from Dallas. All those guys are still playing. So if the Panthers disappeared tomorrow, I mean, you know, I'd miss going to some of the games, like the 2-year when Toronto plays here. But other than that, I don't care, really. I don't care anymore. So don't give me this big song to dance about, well, gee, I really like baseball. If they paid me by the pitch, and there was no bigger baseball fan in the world than me when I was growing up as a kid, and that lasted for many, many, many years, for most of my adult life. And when they had their last work stoppage, and when they basically slapped the public in the face and said, oh, we're not even having a World Series this year, whatever year that was, 94, whenever it was, at that point, I said, screw you guys. And then, of course, when the salaries just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and everybody said, oh, well, gee, we can't make any money, and the owners start crying. Well, what are you crying about? If you're paying guys $252 million, how do you expect to make any money? We're not going to subsidize it. So I just don't have any interest. It's just big business. And all these people who are waxing poetic about, oh, well, there's nothing better than taking your kids to a ball game and having a hot dog. Well, that's all ancient history now. That's all in the past. It doesn't exist anymore. It's a figment of your imagination. You're living in the distant past. Now it's just brazen, big business where guys just whore themselves out to the highest bidder. You got a bunch of mercenaries out there. And whoever pay them the greatest amount of money, that's where they'll go. They don't give a flying crap about any of you. There's no loyalty. There's no allegiance. There's no continuity. Who the hell's on the team? Who are these guys? Oh, yeah, but they got a bunch of good young guys. But who the hell are they? Nobody cares. So you can give a song and a dance on there, Hank, about how you know, it would be embarrassing to lose baseball. And let's come up. What difference does it make how many stadiums you build? The problem isn't the stadium in the first place. Everybody knows that. There's nothing wrong with that stadium. It's in a perfect location. You're driving right off the turnpike. The problem is that the owner got sucked into a bad deal. That's the problem with Neil Bush. Other than the SNLs, I don't think the government usually steps in to bail anybody out, do they?
No.
If you're in private business, are they going to come and do...
All right, I gotta go.
Wait, you can't drive on Cuervo. Come here, you're gonna fall asleep. Just take
it. Let me just put
these lines out. Look at this line.
Oh, no, I can't.
Come on. 36. I'm making a 36 right here. Come on.
I don't do coke anymore, man.
Come on, man.
All right, just walk.
Hey, Robert.
How's that, huh?
Oh, I gotta go.
Rob. We got 2-3 girls waiting for you.
No, I don't do that anymore. All right, just once.
Yeah!
I'm in the saddle again.
Go, Robert. Wait, go. Go ahead. Come here. Vicodin. Come on. I just got a new script yesterday. Come on.
I can't, man.
Oh, come on. Birthday.
I got my groove on, man.
Oh, birthday.
All right, just once.
Ah!
Don't you feel guilty about him? Don't you feel that society is responsible for his aberrant behavior and his constant drug abuse and et cetera and being a scumbag?
Yeah, it's my fault. Never met him, but still.
So cut the crap. By the way, we've had a major change on that survey on Court TV. Do you believe Brazil's account of the shooting? Yes, 15%, no, 85%. So he's improved 1% as he goes on. 85% no, 15% yes. Is that a good...
No.
Not too good, Nathaniel. Maybe if he had his tuba there. Huh? Blow a few notes? Well, here's the thing about Sonny Fox and Ron Hersey, which is interesting, and the Sun Sentinel's not even the least bit interesting about the fact that they're not on the air and trying some lame-ass comedy routine on MP3. Did you see that? They're downloading, or you can download. Do we want their stuff?
No.
This must be in lieu of Tom Zicker writing a piece about the ratings. Every time we have a stupendous rating book, all of a sudden both Kevin Bastard and the Herald and Tom Zicker, nobody cares about the radio ratings, and they're not writing anything about that. How do you like that? I wonder how Castronova feels about that. And what is wrong with... So anyway, here's an update from our friend Paul in Fort Myers. This is the third consecutive day. I thank you profusely. He's keeping us on top of this story. Merrillville, Indiana. Ex-principal and girl found.
Oh!
That's the good news. The bad news, a former Baptist school principal accused of running off with an 11-year-old girl was captured Tuesday by the FBI after the two were found together in a Las Vegas area hotel. Well, at least he took her where they could have a good time. William A. Byth, 28, was arrested on federal charges of coercing and enticing a minor into sexual acts and transporting a minor across state lines for sexual purposes, said FBI agent Doug Garrison in Indianapolis. Both Byth and the girl were safe, Garrison said. He didn't have any other details of the capture. In a hotel in Las Vegas.
Oh!
Viva Las Vegas and viva the Baptist Church and all the other goyim, too. How do you like that? And the Jews, we don't want to leave out that rabbi up there. And where the hell was it? Somewhere up there in...
I missed that story.
What, the rabbi one? No, you didn't a couple weeks ago. Sure, you didn't miss that story. You were here.
Oh, I forgot.
The rabbi that got canned because he was molesting boys and had a prior thing in St. Louis?
I totally forgot that.
Wow.
I must have been out or something.
No, you were not out. Just slipped your mind. You were too worried about the Palestinians.
2 weeks ago, I was on vacation.
You were too worried about the Palestinians. You just killed the two Israeli kids. Anyway.
You want to... Body count? Okay.
Beg your pardon? Yeah.
467.
No, just a sheet count. Anyway, getting back to poor Nate, he's on there right now.
Mr. Greeno was one of my friends.
Oh, there you go. He was one of his friends. He's not his friend anymore. You want to know why, George, he's not his friend anymore? Because he's still dead. How do you like that? He's not his friend anymore because...
He died?
That's the reason. And because Nate put a bullet between his eyes. And he's dead. He was one of his friends. Which contradicts earlier testimony that he told other kids that he didn't like him. And especially when you know you're going to get an F in English. And if you've heard his English, I think you can understand why he was going to get an F in English. Don't you understand?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to ask no tough questions, but I've been listening to his testimony the last 2 days, and he do not sound like an honor student to me. Now, far be it for me to judge, you know? He just does not sound like an honor student to me. And for whatever the reason was, he was going to get an F in English. I guess he ain't going to get it now. He's got an F in life. And Robert Steinbeck says that each and every one of you, all of us, should feel responsible for it. And I must be a bad guy. And you want to know why? Because I don't feel even the slightest iota of responsibility for Nathaniel Brazill, for Lionel Tate wrestling that girl and killing her and breaking all her bones, for the kids out there in Columbine, which I don't even live there. I don't feel responsible for those things. Because I've been saying for years that this is a slaughterhouse and a barbaric place, and that guns do kill people, yes they do, and that people are going to own them, ought to be responsible, and make damn sure that little kids and irresponsible people should be running around every time they get pissed off killing people with their guns. Yeah, and stuff like that. So having attempted to be a voice of reason, a voice of sanity, and otherwise a country of total insanity, I don't feel like I want to be responsible. Maybe that makes you feel bad, Robert Steinbeck, you imbecile you. In fact, you're responsible for writing crap in what is supposed to be a major market newspaper. All over the place. I mean, he's all over the map here with this thing. And finally, at the end of the article, if you have a strong stomach and get to the last part where, oh, yeah, well, he must be disciplined for his actions and ascribing responsibility to society never removes it from the individual. Well, so what are you saying? He's saying both things. He wants to have it both ways, but he's desperately trying to make excuses and uses all those adjectives, you know, about poor young Nathaniel, this screwed up, confused, frightened boy. Did he look confused and frightened to you?
Confused.
I'm watching him right now. He don't look frightened to me.
He looks confused
by life.
Looks
like a smart ass to me. Looks like a real con artist to me. And a liar. Yeah,
by the way,
a murderer, yes?
If he's let out, if he's a dangerous killer at 13,
what could he be by the time he's 20?
Yeah.
Plus, he had this fascination with guns. You know, he wanted to be a cop, then he wanted to be a Secret Service agent to protect presidents. Huh. He'd have fit right in back in 63, I guess. 5670560, pound 560. Oh, and I also want to correct one other thing because I've got a lot of stuff on my plate. Brian Murray is not the general manager of the Chicago Blackhawks. About 10 days ago, somebody came in here and handed me a thing from the sports department there. Brian Murray had been named the GM of the Blackhawks. Well, what is that all about? Mike Smith is still a general manager. Brian Sutter is the... And I made several comments, jokes about that during the last 10 days, which nobody corrected me because nobody out there knows a damn thing about hockey. And he didn't get the job. He was up for the coach. He was under consideration BM. And they said, no, we don't want no BM. We'll take BS instead. And so it took my good close friend Rimmer last night call me in between that Penguin-Buffalo game to correct me on that. Absolutely right, Rimmer. And no, I'm still not buying dinner. But at any rate, it's amazing how much misinformation gets on here in this place.
Uh-huh.
It's astonishing. And what's even more astonishing is that nobody out there knows what they're talking about. But hey, it's typical for South Florida, isn't it?
All right.
Yeah. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T line. Probably a lot of folks watching the trial this morning. I understand that. You got my permission. I'm sitting here watching it myself. Here's Fort Myers. Hello.
Hey, how you doing, Neil?
Pretty good, sir.
The only thing is, it's totally this kid's responsibility, but I just feel sad in a way that this kid has thrown away his life. I mean, it's sad, but...
Well, what about the life of the teacher?
Well, no, I understand that, Neil. I understand that, Neil, but...
He took away somebody else's
life. You're right. No, I'm not disputing that at all.
There's nothing in the world worse than you can do, other than unless it's multiple lives, than taking away somebody else's life.
No, you have no argument.
So then why are you concerned that he's throwing away his life? Nobody else forced him to do it.
It's a sad thing. It's just a sad thing, Neil. It's just a sad thing. It's just what I don't know.
That is a sad thing, but to me it's a zillion times worse, much sadder, that the teacher who was a responsible, decent person with a wife and family, that he's dead. That's much sadder to me. Maybe my priorities are screwed up, but to me that's a lot sadder.
What I really called to ask you about was later this year, I am going to Vegas for the first time, and I wanted to ask you your opinion of the Excalibur Hotel.
Yeah, George is sticking his finger down his throat. If you're into going to Disney World and you have like a lot of little punky kids, it's okay, but I wouldn't go there.
But I heard, you know...
Why would you want to go there?
Well, I'm going there because a part of my job, it's like a pool thing. We're like $480 for 5 nights.
Right.
Airfare included from Tampa to...
Well, I mean, you can stay there, but you just don't spend any time in there. I mean, you got the walk over. You can go across to the MGM, New York, the Tropicana, and all over the Strip. But you don't want to spend any time in there.
Everything's walking distance from there.
Yeah, the restaurants suck, and you don't want to spend any time in there.
I hear the New York's pretty cool.
It's okay. I like the MGM, which is right across the street.
All right. Well, listen, I still think George is fudge packing. Take care.
How do you like that? Was that a great call or what? I guess he covered all the bases. Maybe he'll run into that Baptist minister and little girl in the Excalibur.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, from Indiana. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. George is weeping right now. Why does he weep? Because we took that call. And I feel the same. Yesterday I didn't take too many calls, to be honest with you. And I went through a whole tirade about the fact that callers on the talk shows generally suck, not just on this show. In fact, the callers on the sports shows are much worse than this. I heard some little Julio calling Hank yesterday talking about the Kentucky Derby. This kid had no idea what he was talking about. None. And that's generally what you hear, because it's here. So why should you expect this to be a sports town? They don't even understand what they're talking about. They claim to be big football fans. They don't even understand that. That's their claim to fame. Oh, this is a football town. Okay, whatever you say. They do show up for the Dolphin games, I'll say that. But other than that, they don't know what they're talking about. They don't even get it. Here's a mobile in Cooper City. Hello.
How you doing now?
Great.
This ain't no sports town.
Yeah.
You take the Marlins don't draw.
That's what I just said.
Nobody.
Yeah.
If you took cell phones away from the Panthers game, nobody would go there.
Right.
And the Dolphins, the only reason they go there is to get trashed and get bombed in the parking lot 3 hours before the game.
Yeah.
That's, you know, that's what it is. You know, that's what you got done here. But, you know, this guy here, he killed the dude. He, you know, he took away a family man with two kids. Now they got to grow up with a father. Nobody thinks of that. It's an absolute joke.
Mm-hmm.
The kid's got to go to jail for the rest of his life.
I mean, how come the first thing that seems to come into the minds of people like this last idiot from Fort Myers, who finally showed what an idiot he was at the end of the call, but nevertheless, the first thing that comes to mind is, well, it's so sad that this kid has thrown away his life. Well, who forced him to do that? Ted Bundy threw away his life. All those other people I mentioned threw away their lives. Nobody forced them to commit aberrant acts.
Absolutely.
And
it doesn't matter what his age is. He pulled out the gun, shot him in the head, killed the guy.
Any kid that's 13 years old that doesn't know the difference between right and wrong and blowing somebody away, I'm sorry. But we got real problems with that. See, the other kid, Lionel Tate, I still think that kid is emotionally disturbed and needs to be like in a some kind of a psychiatric facility for a long, long time, if not forever, because he's dangerous. But this kid's not emotionally disturbed. He was cold and calculating. He planned this whole thing out. He was pissed off and fired up, and he told his friends he was going to go back and F up the school, and first he was going to drive the car through the school, and that didn't work out, so he went and got the gun. And then he said he was going to go and kill the teacher, and his name would be all over the media. But now, a year later, he's got a whole different story, because that story isn't going to fly in court. That's not going to play too well by the jury. So now we got a whole different story that they got cooked up for him. And amazingly, his testimony in every respect conflicts with each and every one of the witnesses, all his classmates, all his buddies. They got a different story. So like I said, the whole world is out of step, and good old Nathaniel, he's the only one who's marching to the right drummer, the right tuba player. Here's Miami Beach.
Hello.
Here's the mobile in Key West. Hello.
Hey, yeah, Neil?
Yes, sir.
There's more to that Baptist principal story than you heard.
Yeah.
It's in the USA Today. He was previously arrested for sex with his minor.
All right.
And before he got promoted, his father was the principal of that school, Baptist principal.
Mm-hmm.
He was arrested for soliciting oral sex from a undercover male cop.
Great. Okay, so it runs in the family of an
hour. I know, it runs in their family.
And so now, don't you feel responsible for that?
Most definitely.
I do, too.
Well, it's always great listening to you.
Okay.
Have a good day.
Thanks a lot, and get a new phone. 5670560 #560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Oh, but he's a man of the Lord, the man of the cloth, yeah, huh? Always good to have a cloth around just in case. Yeah, Bubba would have just had a cloth around. He probably he might even still be in there. Might have got a third term. We might have changed the law just to get him back in there. We liked him so much. Although he wasn't quite dumb enough, I guess. 5670560 #560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Poor Nate. What are we going to do about poor Nate? Huh? And let me say it again, except for the one mentioned, I guess he just had to get the name in there, the teacher that he murdered. Robert Steinbeck doesn't seem to be the least bit concerned about the consequences of this act. And the fact that here's a, you know, very civilized, decent, worthwhile person who's, you know, I'm sure that intelligent people can do a lot more lucrative things than teaching public school. Believe me when I tell you that. A lot safer things. Things that are a lot more appreciated in a society that has a priority and all their priorities all screwed up and doesn't place a high priority in education. But he chose to do that. And he's dead and won't see him no more. But don't you feel bad for poor Nate?
No.
No, I do not. No, I don't. And if there was a legal way to fry his ass, I'd be more than delighted to pull the switch. Does that sound...
Disturbing video of kids guzzling down alcohol like soda.
Gets us all pretty drunk for free.
See what we caught on camera. Watch the next Inside Edition.
Inside Edition, weeknights at 7 on 7.
Sports Radio 560, WQAM Miami, Fort Lauderdale. A Beasley broadcast group station. And WQAM.com for the world.
Takes forever to get that taste and smell out of your system.
Hey, Bill, what's for breakfast?
The usual fruit, toast, cereal. That's good, right?
Wrong, Bill.
That's my breakfast, my
Here, try this.
That's meat.
2 pounds of chuck.
For breakfast, but I...
Despite what those health nuts will tell you, Bill, meat has all the vitamins and minerals you need to start the day off right. Plus, it'll give you that aggressive edge that's so important in today's competitive world.
But what about all the cholesterol?
Oh, come on, Bill. You can't escape the inevitable. In a few short years, you'll be dead. Fodder for the worms, sleeping eternally in the cold embrace of death. Your rotting corpse...
Okay, I get the picture. Hey, pass that meat.
There's a smart fellow.
And while you're at it, pass the salt, too.
When having breakfast, don't leave out the most important food group of all, meat.
Good.
Remember, it ain't complete if you leave out the meat.
Meat good.
Yes, meat good.
Paid for by the American Meat Council.
Big goal by Mario Lemieux if you join us late. In regulation, that tied the game for the Penguins, giving them the opportunity to come back and win this game and extend the series. In front goal. The Penguins have won the game here in overtime as Marty Straka forces a seventh game, his second overtime winner. And ladies and gentlemen, Elvis has just left the building. It's Marty Straka once again.
And I apologize for Eddie Olchek getting carried away like a washerwoman there screeching out. That was pretty embarrassing on Fox Sports, Eddie O. Sorry, Eddie, but control yourself, okay? Well, it was pretty exciting. 5670, any interest here?
No.
I mean, the notion that this is a sports town is as laughable as the idea that we're going to open up a halava stand in Montpelier, Vermont. That's how ridiculous it is. In Johnson City, Tennessee. Although George was up there teaching him Yiddish, which I think is a good start. 5670560, and then made a hasty exit. #560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. Here's a mobile in Gould's. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
First of all, you think they'd be making...
I can barely hear you, sir.
You think they'd be making a big deal if this kid wasn't black?
I beg your pardon?
I
don't think Robert Steinbeck would be.
Well, okay. And the next thing, there's a rumor going out there that Fidel is going to cut...
Okay, great. 5670560, #560 on the AT&T. See, he heard me say something about cheats, and I guess he figured compelled to call.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Ah, Jesus. Woody Graber, what do you want?
Well, I wanted to let you know that I call sometimes even after the Sabres lose. It was a great game last night.
Uh-huh.
Very enjoyable.
Yeah, it was. And I was rooting very hard for the Penguins. Sabres turned out to be a much dirtier, more desperate team than I thought they were. They have some very good skilled players like Chetan and Nafinigano, but very dirty, holding and clutching and tackling. The Penguins won that game in spite of some of the worst officiating I've ever seen in my life. In the first 2 minutes of the game, Tsipelkov just about butchered Mario Lemieux. No penalty was called. And then you get Verrata with that high stick that should have at least minimum 4 minute penalty. It gets 2 minutes. So
well,
the Sabres are very lucky that, let me say it again, should have been at least four. You don't have to draw blood for four. But yeah, the Sabres were very lucky that they were even in that game.
Well, you know, Hasek seemed to keep him in it pretty good, and that
yeah,
one.
Plus, he must have gone about 400 miles last night. Was he getting paid on a per foot basis
like
last night?
Oh, he was all over the place.
Yeah.
And but that, did you see that save by Zidnik?
Yeah.
Where he slid in front.
No, it was Stu Barnes who stopped it, not Zidnik. That was Stu Barnes.
That was Zidnik.
No, let me say it again. It was Stu Barnes who saved the one when the net was open there at the end of the second period. Stu Barnes.
Oh, okay.
And doesn't it bring a tear to every real hockey fan's eye, every one of the 50 of us here in South Florida, that to see Stu Barnes and Marty Straka and Rhett Warner and all these others play so prominently here in the playoffs and Scott Mellenby, but the organization here continues diluting and diluting to the point where we have nothing left, and the fan base for all of these teams continues getting smaller and smaller and smaller because you can't put the Limburger out there on the table and sell it as Chateaubriand. People aren't going to buy it.
Totally, totally. There's just no one out there other than Pavel that just, you know, keeps it going.
Well, he ain't keeping it going.
Yeah.
There's no interest.
Yeah.
Well, good luck to you tomorrow night, Woody, and wish the Leafs luck tonight. He's not listening to a word I'm saying. Wish us luck. A Buffalo-Toronto series would be great.
I'd love a Buffalo-Toronto
series. Okay, go get a haircut, okay, and say hi to Fat Boy. 5670560, #560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. Here's a mobile in Miami. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was listening yesterday to the live the talk of the kid that killed the teacher.
Uh-huh.
That kid knows exactly what he did, and he killed somebody, and he needs to go and serve his time for it. I don't see what the big controversy is.
And you don't feel responsible for it?
Oh, everybody's responsible for it the way this world is nowadays. These kids don't know what's right and wrong, but, I mean, if you go by that, then you're never going to put anybody in jail.
And so you really believe that you are responsible for it?
Not directly responsible. The world is responsible. Not me directly responsible.
How is the world responsible?
Well, maybe responsible is a bad choice of words. Then maybe it's just a
If somebody else is responsible, then how come all the other kids who are in the same surroundings as he is aren't bringing guns to school and shooting teachers every day?
Well, I guess what you're saying is right. It's just he's just a screw up then.
He did it. Period.
He did it. And you know, they're talking about he went and he cocked the gun in front of the kids, and then they're saying that he was going to take the gun to learn how to shoot it. He already knew how to shoot the gun and put the bullets and all that stuff. It's just he knew what he did.
Yeah, his buddy from South Carolina already taught him how to do the gun and
That's
load it
his
and
uncle.
Shoot it. Uh-huh.
They got to keep it in the family, I guess.
Okay, pal. Have a great day.
All right. You too.
5670560. Pal, got many open lines here for some bizarre reason. Well, they're probably all watching the trial today. Uh-huh. Like I said, you're certainly probably be more interested. You know, I've already had 65 faxes of this already. This fantasy, this study says some gays can go straight. That's like saying that some blacks can go white. Oh, look at that. The lights are flashing. Must be an act of God.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
As soon as you said that.
As soon as I said that.
Damn, God.
Lights started flickering like
crazy.
Come on,
there's hope for you.
Yeah.
You want a wife and a family.
Right. Dr. Robert Spitzer, a psychiatry professor at Columbia University in South Carolina, who led the study, says he can't estimate what percentage of highly motivated gay people can change their sexual orientation, but it's probably just about as high as the number of people who can change their skin color. Right. So you can do your Anthony Perkins or whoever else, and you can go get married and pretend to be something all you want to satisfy all these homophobes, or you can just be whatever you are. The choice is yours. But don't waste any more of my fax paper. I already had 30 copies of that and not interested. More fairy tales from the right wing, from the good religionists, like that Baptist minister that abducted an 11-year-old girl and sexually abused her and took her off to Vegas. I guess you could say he took a gamble,
uh-huh.
That's what he did, and lost. Like usually happens in Vegas, you take a gamble and lost. And evidently he had a good time, too, for a while. Is that line 6 out again? It's been that way for days now. Yeah, line 6 is out again. I just mentioned that. I don't want to ruffle the feathers of our engineering department because they're probably busy playing pinochle. Or maybe getting the cards in there so the guys that work in the room across the hall can get their thing to come in the door there. I mentioned that the other day. They were standing out there cooling their heels, and I luckily for them walked out and took a leak and opened the door so they could get in, and I heard one scream to the other, gee, George Corso told me 2 months ago he was going to get us those cards to open the door 2 months ago. And I mentioned
maybe that's a message.
Yeah. No, maybe the message is that George Corso ain't doing anything. You think that's a message?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's typical. Don't hold your breath, guys. And plus, what the hell are you guys doing in there anyway? Oh, each other? 8 minutes after 11 at 560 WQM. This Mother's Day is Sunday, May 13th. Or is it the other way around? Mother's Day is this Sunday. Either way you look at it, Sunday, May 13th, day after Saturday. Make Mom happy by sending her Bear Graham gift to the Vermont Bear, Teddy Bear Company. It's a fun, original way to let Mom know she's loved and appreciated. Your mom, wife, or grandma will receive a beautiful bear handcrafted in Vermont and personalized just for her with a candy and card, all delivered in colorful gift box. Just call a friendly bear counselor, 1-800-829-BEAR, and choose from over 100 bears like the Do-It-All Mom or Mama's Boy with a heart-shaped mom tattoo. There's even a pregnancy bear. Tailor a bear to your mom's occupation or hobby with a nurse, doctor, teacher, slut, or gardening bear. Sending a bear gram is a creative alternative to flowers that your mom will love forever. Send a bear to the office so all the coworkers can see just how thoughtful you are, and you can be a really big shot for a little while. It's your job, Dads, to get mom a present from the kids, too, and the mother and cup set is a really nifty idea. Think about it. Overnight and weekend delivery is guaranteed, so call this. What we got at 6 o'clock. Again, and I guess Mad Dog, I heard him bellyaching about it on Friday. He charges a little bit too much.
Uh-huh.
That's the problem. So we have to go low rent district this week because the Marlins are on the West Coast. So once again, at 6 tonight, we got
Joe Zagacki.
Oh, God. 6 to 9, 3 hours. Might as well shut the transmitter off and save the juice. Did he say save the juice?
Uh-huh.
9 o'clock, you got your Dizzy Crow, and then 9:30 the pregame. Marlins at the Dodgers. Marlins won last night 7-6. I mentioned that in passing. Any interest?
No.
No. Here's Miami. Hello.
Hey, Neil. How you doing?
Okay, sir.
Good. I hate to do this to you, but it was Jitnick, not Stu Barnes, that made that.
Well, they said it was Stu Barnes, so I excuse them.
Well, it was 44. I just happened to see
okay,
it right
well,
now.
Okay, well, does it really make a difference?
Second thing was that the Bruins just signed Robbie Fatorik as their new head coach.
Yeah, and nobody here cares.
All right, that's it.
They don't even know who that is.
Talk to you later.
Okay,
bye.
See ya. Good job with the Devils there, Robbie. Oh, I'm sorry. They fired him. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T. Oh, it's a hockey show today. Is that what it is?
No.
No, I don't think so. Let me say it again. This isn't a hockey town. It's not a baseball town. It's not a sports town. It's a horse and buggy town. Always has been, always will be. It's a banana boat town. It's a early bird town. That's it. I mean, if you want to be pissed off at me for saying that, go ahead and be pissed off. That's the truth. That's not the way I like it. I'm not happy about that. But that's just the way it is. That's what you are. Hit him again, Pete. Come on, Pete. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Here's a mobile in North Miami Beach. Hello.
Neil, how you doing?
Great.
Hey, I watched Passions yesterday.
All right.
For the first time.
Yesterday was pretty interesting.
I guess it's got some kind of supernatural theme to it.
Well, the whole thing is ridiculous. You're right.
It kind of reminds
me of... Witches and gremlins, goblins.
You remember Dark Shadows?
Yeah.
That was great.
Yeah, but this is more fun than Dark Shadows.
Yeah. I may watch it again today.
Too many biting comments on Dark Shadows.
Hey, as far as that Brazill kid, he knew exactly what he was doing.
Yes.
I don't feel responsible for him.
You don't?
And while
well, Robert Steinbeck's going to be knocking on your door about 3 in the morning to give you a lecture right to your face, mister.
Hey, since they're going to have the table set up next week for McVeigh anyway,
yeah.
Send Tate and Nate and stand them in line.
Put one under each arm would be good.
Take
Strap
care.
Them all down. Okay, thank you. That's not a bad idea. 3 for 1.
Oh!
56705. Oh, you're cruel and barbaric. You're heartless. Oh, yeah, I'm heartless. Uh-huh. Nobody cares about victims, like I said. That's why we have victims advocacy groups in this country. We shouldn't have to have those things, but we do, because generally speaking, the victims, they're not very exciting anymore because they're dead, see? So you don't see them being interviewed every 5 minutes on TV. And most of the time, their relatives are grieving too much, so they don't want to be bothered. Unless it's Fred Goldman who wants, to get a TV show because he's got a big mustache. Never see Fred Goldman and Lanny McDonald together?
No.
No. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Here's a mobile in Weston. Hello.
Hello. How you doing, Neil?
Pretty good, sir.
Well, I'm not pissed off at you for saying it's not a sports town, but I'd have to disagree with you. I don't think it's any different than any other town. You know,
Wrong.
Is that the end of my call?
No, but it's just wrong. Your point is wrong. It's not the end of your call. You can say whatever you want.
If we can compare it to some other places, I mean, take a look at the Pittsburgh Penguins. I mean, before Mario Lemieux came back in
Pittsburgh is not a sports town either. Nobody ever said it was.
Well, I mean, how many towns do we have to go through before we can compare it?
This is what happened with expansion, sir, when they got greedy and they wanted to squeeze $100 million out of franchises and split up the money amongst themselves.
But that's not the fan. That's not the fans. You're talking fans. You know, that's the business of sports. You know, the fans
you're not letting me finish.
Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
The point being that they wound up putting major league franchises into cities that couldn't or wouldn't support them. That's the point, and that is the fans.
Well, I could agree with you there for sure, but, you take a look at a place like New York City, they've got mass transportation, they've got population that doubles our size, and they can get people to the ball games even midday, midweek.
Yeah, what about St. Louis?
St. Louis.
What about Detroit?
Are they downtown stadiums?
Detroit does. They aren't putting anybody in that stadium. They just build them a brand new stadium. They're not drawing flies.
Well, we're talking about South Florida, and our sports fans.
Well, no, you were just talking about New York now, but if I mention someplace else that you don't know about, then we're talking about South Florida again. This is not a major league sports town, sir, and it never will be. It never, never, ever will be. And the idea, you can build 50 stadiums, they can be like the Taj Mahal, and if there's no interest in... Why would they be going to a stadium in a place that they don't want to go to, where they can't get to and have to pay an arm and leg to park? Why are they going to go there when they're not going to the place we got now?
Sir? I don't know. I just feel like you don't give fans in this area.
I asked you a question. Why would they be going there at the riverfront? Why will they go to Miami if they won't go to the county line?
Well, I'd have to say that if you can get into a downtown area where you can get people to get out of the office buildings midday, and
how many midday? How many people are going to leave the office? This isn't Chicago where they have businessmen's ball games. This is Miami. How many people work downtown? Do you work downtown?
Probably, well, take a look at the skyline over there. There's plenty of businesses over there where you've got people.
How much time do you spend in downtown Miami?
I spend virtually no time in downtown Miami.
Okay, good. Then call me back when you can talk about something you know something about. He knows nothing about St. Louis. He knows nothing about Detroit. He knows nothing about downtown Miami. But I'm being unfair to our great fans down here. Sir, I hate to break the news to you. I've been to Marlin games. Well, in the first 2-3 years we had the team, I went to a lot of games, okay? And I sat there and listened to the inane comments of the idiots that were sitting around me. I've been probably to more Panther games in the last since we had the franchise than 99% of you put together, okay? And up until this last season, I've been to every Panther home game when I was in town. Every single one up until this last year. And why did I stop going? Because I just lost my interest. Even though they built it like... I could walk, really, from my house to where the arena is. It'd be a long walk, but I could do it. I could walk there and back. I get free tickets. The only thing I pay for is my parking. And I still have no interest in going most of the time. It's lame. It's crap. You can't package garbage and try to sell it as steak. People aren't going to keep buying it. and you can't keep cranking the price up and up and up and whining and begging and pleading, oh, you got to build me a new facility because this one isn't good enough because I can't pay any more millions. It's insanity. It's craziness. And especially in a place that's got an excuse for everything, why they won't do this, why they won't do that. Oh, there's a cloud in the sky. That's a good excuse that nobody going today. This past Sunday was the most beautiful example I've ever seen. The beach in Fort Lauderdale just jammed with people. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people at a time for the air show. And if you're into the air show, fine. I'm not. But if that's your thing, fine. It's not a sport. I mean, if you want to see them dropping watermelons in the ocean, that's great. Rumor is they won't be doing that again next year. They heard my threat about the dark folks catching on to that. Yeah, they'll have nothing but charts there next year if they find out there's watermelons in the ocean. Although they can't swim, but anyway.
Watermelons can't?
Watermelons can, but dark folks can't. Now, if the watermelons could float, they could ride them all the way in the part of that BTA program, like I said, back to Africa, right on that watermelon. Just keep the seeds in there to keep it afloat. That's a good lesson for you. But this guy wants to give me a... He doesn't know anything about any of these other areas, but he's going to give me a lesson and a lecture. And then he uses Pittsburgh as an example. Piss-poor, piece-of-crap sports town. They just built that palatial new stadium for the Pirates. Are they going to be filling that up?
No,
because they got a crap team. And even when they had good teams, they couldn't fill up Forbes Field when they had good teams. They couldn't fill up Three Rivers. They had no attendance. The only thing that they go there in Pittsburgh is because the football team. It's a one, just like here. It's an industrial town. It's not like a big megalopolis there, Pittsburgh, and never will be. It's a working class town. It's a blue collar town. It's not a city where they ought to have a hockey team. Do they have an NBA team?
No.
Of course not, for good reason. But, you know, just keep watering it down and watering it down. Let's have more and more franchises, more and more millions and millions and millions. You suckers keep paying more and more of your tax money. Keep paying more for your tickets. And the public is saying, oh, I don't think so. But I'm the bad guy because I'm telling you the truth. And some of you sports nerds out there just can't accept it. Just the way it is. Mobile in Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Hey.
Yes, sir. Get a new phone, pal. Call me on a phone that works. Sound like a two tin cans and a string.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Here's Plantation. Hello. Plantation. Going once. Going twice. Okay, many, many open lines. 567-0560, #560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. They want to talk about Nathaniel Brazill?
No.
About the article I read by Robert Steinbeck?
No.
About the Marlins, about the stadium they're going to put through by hook or by crook?
No.
About the election in July?
No.
About any of these things? No. No, they don't want to do it. Here's a mobile in Deerfield. Hello.
You know, you can't even fill up your phone lines. How are we going to fill up a damn stadium?
Right. You know? I've said that many times. That's right. I can't even. That doesn't cost them a dime to call, and I still can't get the half a dozen calls.
You know, the big deal with this town, Neil, is that everybody's from somewhere else. Everybody's home team is way up north somewhere, and they don't give a crap about this town unless it's something to see for free, like the air show.
Yeah. Man, that's right. The air show was free. I never thought about that. Good point.
Yeah, exactly. It's free.
Yeah.
Free. And you, mm-hmm. But, you know, the only game, you know, hate me for this, probably hang up on me, but the only games I ever really went to see was U of M back when I was in my younger days.
Yeah.
That was about the only thing that was local.
So why am I going to hang up on you for saying that?
Well, I know you hate the UM with a passion, but, you know.
I broadcast UM baseball for 6 years.
This was before.
And that. You know something? We had more people coming out to those. When they played FSU or Florida, we had more people coming to those games than the Marlins get for many of the games now.
Well,
how do you like
exactly,
that?
Exactly. That Mark Light Field, they'd fill it up overflowing. Now, if they could fill up a stadium, it's the same proportion. But no, these people, you know, it's a tourist town. It'll always be a tourist town.
Yeah.
I mean, I used to live in Tampa. Now, Tampa, we used to fill up the stadium there, you know, for anything.
Oh, yeah, they're doing a real good job for baseball, not. Uh-huh.
Well, I mean, I'm talking about the old.
Sir, let me say it again. They are drawing flies for baseball in Tampa. That franchise, that one will be gone before this one.
Maybe the NBC needs to do something like the XFL with baseball.
Yeah, okay,
you know?
Great. 567-0560. Yeah, as a matter of fact, they probably get the same number of people to watch that as they're getting into ballparks right now down here in Florida. Same number of people that watch the XFL on TV and the same...
Same nine
people. See, I don't know what it is. It's like trying to convince people of like the sun is out there. You know, walk outside, it's blue sky, the sun is shining. Oh, that's the sun up there. Oh, no, it's not. No, it's not. Where do you see that? What are you talking about? You have to be deaf, dumb, blind, a total ass fool not to understand that this just ain't going to fly here. And I have one part of me that hopes that they actually, because I don't live in Dade County, it's not going to cost me a dime. I have one part of me that hopes they do go ahead and put it over on you again. So that people like Hank and some of the other people who keep riding the fence and keep waxing all romantic about, oh, I love baseball. Big stinking deal. It just ain't going to fly here. I love hockey, too. And like I said, if they close down the team tomorrow, it isn't going to change my life. I'm sick and tired of wasting night after night and watching the same tired old people in their belly aching about, oh, gee, who don't even know what the hell they're talking about. We got about 50 fans in that place who even understand the game. And the rest of them, they're on their cell phones and they're out there milling around in the hallway with their social club. And you listen to the people behind you talking crap, talking about stories about their fantasies in Vietnam and all that. Just nonsense. And then the stuff that they are talking about that might even relate to the game, they haven't got a Chinaman's chance of having any idea what they're talking about. Hit him again, Pete. Man. And there's a good test for it, too. Anybody that's ever been to a sporting event in other cities as opposed to being the one here? Ah, think about that test. That test of what this market's all about. 26 after 11 at 560 QM. It's Mother's Day very soon, as in this Sunday. But there's nothing better than flowers to tell Mom that you love her. But if you call any florist, you're
.com for store locations. You're listening to Real Sports Radio. Sports Radio 560 QAM.
Why are you airing shit like this?
Now, the Sopranos update in 60 seconds flat. Meadow and Jackie Jr. start to get hot and heavy. Yes. Jackie Jr. gives her some ecstasy, but as things heat up, Meadow falls asleep.
I think I'm gonna explode.
Then, the Tony Ralphie saga continues. Tony's still mad that Ralphie killed the stripper, and Ralphie's mad at Tony for hitting him.
Hey.
Tony wants an apology, and Ralphie wants to become a captain.
I
want to
be a capo.
No.
Then, Gigi, the guy Tony passed Ralphie over for, pulls an Elvis and dies on the toilet. So guess what? Ralphie becomes a captain. Tony bumps into a hot Mercedes-Benz dealer at Dr. Melfi's office and suddenly has an urge to buy that new Mercedes coupe and have sex with the salesperson.
Yes!
This
yes.
being the Sopranos, he test drives the Mercedes. And the salesperson.
Whoa!
Back to annoying Meadow and Jackie Jr. She's drunk, takes Jackie's car, and drives it off the road. And dies!
Yeah!
No, she's fine.
Ah!
The Sopranos update in 60 seconds flat.
11:31 at 560 WQM. Join George this Friday, 5 to 7 at the Shell location, 2600 North 29th Avenue, just west of I-95 on Sheridan. Oh, that's by where we used to work, over by where Paxton used to be, right? Is Queer Channel in there, in that building? No? Oh, maybe you can stop by and see our good buddy, what's his name, Jack Martz.
They're not there anymore.
Oh. Is anybody in there?
I don't know.
Oh, well, you can find out. Well, you can go in by and see Bob and Cheryl.
Sure.
Anyway, this Friday, 5 to 7 at the Shell station located 2600 North 29th Avenue, just west of I-95 on Sheridan. Stop by and enjoy free food from Atlantic City Subs, where Ira makes the difference. Boy. Win prizes, road atlases, and $10 gas cards while they last. Now that, that might bring somebody by.
Okay. And I'll also be cleaning windshields for everyone who stops by.
No, you won't. You will?
If they have a squeegee, I'll clean windshields.
Okay. George will clean your windshield, too. He'll lick it. That, and the windshield, too. 5 to 7 this Friday at the Shell station on Sheridan with George, who's desperate to get somebody out there because it's embarrassing.
Plus, I like saying squeegee.
Okay. He likes licking it. And your window, too. 5670560. How's? Oh, look at that. Market made a little comeback there. It looked like it was going to be a disastrous day. Might not be after all. Now, get back to Court TV now. We've got one of the teachers on there on the stand, and she's saying...
Great as it was.
Yeah, great as it was. Here's Miami. Hello.
Yes, Neil.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Great.
I'm a schwatzer who thinks Nate Brazill should be fried.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
But I want to clear up a couple of things about your stereotyping of black people.
Stereotyping black people?
Yeah. First of all, we do not all look for handouts. We do not all speak Ebonics.
Yeah, when did I say you do?
Well, hear me out now.
No, well, I'm not going to hear you out because I'm not going to let you misstate things that I've never said. I've never said that you all do anything.
Okay, well, we don't all share the same values.
And when did I say that you do?
Well, it seems like you do. If I wanted to stereotype you, I could say, you know, are you a member of Mambla because you're gay? You're an old gay guy?
Not this week, no. Did I ask you if you were a member of a crime...
Well, when you say schwarze, you know, doesn't that mean black? You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm assuming you speak about all black people. I mean, you clump us up into one group as if we're just one.
Well, when I speak about all black people by saying what?
Well, like you said about the Air Sea Show, watermelons,
yeah,
and stuff like that.
Oh, so in other words, you find that offensive? You don't find any humor
about
watermelons?
No, I do find it.
Watermelons and fried chicken and chitlins, and I guarantee you that there are plenty of black folks who are over there at the ocean right now digging them watermelons up.
You know, you're right.
So what's wrong with that? What's wrong with a free watermelon?
There's nothing wrong with that, but, I mean, you make it seem like, it, you know,
so in other words, are you saying that black people don't eat watermelon?
Sure we do.
So then how am I wrong?
But I cannot speak for all black people. And, you know,
I never met a black person in my life who didn't like watermelon.
well, I love your show, Neil, but, you know, a couple of things you say, it's a little disturbing.
And fried chicken? Do you eat fried chicken?
Sure do.
Churches or Bojangles?
I love fried chicken.
Churches or Bojangles? Huh?
Bojangles.
And not Kentucky Fried, right?
Actually, I do like Kentucky Fried.
Oh, well, you're not black. That's the end of that call. He's not black. He's put on a voice. Black people, it's just like black people like Motown. Do they like Motown? No, they don't. That'd be like saying that black people like Destiny's Child. No way. And in fact, I commend black people. I commend anybody who hates Destiny's Child because they make me nauseous. And now we got 75 groups just like Destiny's Child. They all look the same. They all sound the same. They all smell the same. They all dress the same. They make me barf Destiny's Child. Right, child? Right. Let's play Honey Child by Fats Domino.
Uh-huh.
I like that. It was on the other side of Blueberries Hill. 5670560. So what the heck I just say? Something about farces? Here's a mobile in Miami. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
How are we going to fill up the stadium when we got Rick Sanchez outside killing them, you know?
Uh-huh, okay. Good one. Great call, sir. I'm sure it took you at least, 4 or 5 seconds to think of that?
Uh-huh.
Brilliant. Let's see. Pretty dumb question today, but I had to make it simple because Eric is in town and he's busy eating all day. Eric's in an eating seminar today, so we didn't have time to like put a really meaningful question on our website. Probably won't get a big response. Do you think that most Americans take responsibility for their own actions? No, 23, and yes, 2. 2 people say yeah. Of course, there's no point in having a poll question if everybody's going to answer the same. But we got 2 people out there say, oh yeah, most Americans take responsibility for their own actions. Yeah, I agree with that. Here's Fort Myers. Hello.
Hey, Neil, how you doing?
Pretty good.
Hey, we're looking that poll question you got there. I agree. I think we need to build a new rodeo arena.
Yeah, there you go. Uh-huh.
Rodeo. World twist and twirl.
Yeah, uh-huh. There he is again. World twist and twirl. In fact, that's what he's been doing all day, whirling it, twisting it, and twirling it.
Squirt, squirt.
There he goes. That's what they do most of the time over there on the West Coast.
Uh-huh.
World twist and the squirrel. 5670560. Boy, it's so sad. I still say that they like floated downstream from Johnson City, Tennessee.
Nashville.
Oh, yeah.
Wall-eyed mugwumps.
That's right. Wall-eyed mugwumps. That's the west coast of Florida. We got some nice people over there on the west coast listening to us on 770, about 7 or 8. That's why they keep chopping us shorter and shorter over there, because they're more into that real intellectual stuff, like the stock market show. And then the Cleo going to have her own show on there pretty soon.
Mm-mm-mm.
5670560. And what's the Juliet one? The ripoff. We got a new one now. The Juliet.
Oh, I
haven't seen her.
I don't watch Spick TV.
No, she's not on Spick TV. She's like all over the place.
Oh, I don't
really at Cleo. I mean, Cleo's not on Haitian TV or Jamaican TV.
She's on everything.
She's all over the place. She's like
on fire.
She's on your bedspread. She's on your tablecloth. She's on your doily. In fact, I saw her on that black doily that Kane wears on his head. Yeah. Oh, I'm telling you, every Sunday, it's part of my weekend routine. If I'm home between 1 and 2, it's that public access station, and there's Mr. Ego. With the, like looking through a negative photo print. I mean, you just barely make anything out on the screen, which adds to the ambiance of the whole thing.
Uh-huh.
But you can't see that black doily he's got on his head and all the other phony body parts. It is special. Last week, he had some S&M guy, big fat guy, tied up with in bondage, you know, with the whole thing. I watched about 30 seconds of that.
Not Sir Midian.
I don't know. I don't watch long enough to find out. He had a big circumference. And his waist, too. 5670560 pound 5. That's what I would say about that show. What a waste. Wow. Nice going, Harrison. Okay.
It's the Marlins and Dodgers tonight.
The new voice of the Marlins, Dave Van Horn and Sean Boog Shambi, call it for you.
Coverage starts with Chivas Regals talking hardball with the Crow at 9. Cincermatic's Marlins on deck at 9:35 on Sports Radio 560 QAM.
I've got 2 sets of lips.
Welcome to the biggest dink. Any of these 5 men in the studio tonight could win up to $1 million. They don't know each other. However, if they want to win the money, they will have to prove to me they can be the biggest dink. Let's start the clock. William, during World War II, what U.S. general referred to his advance headquarters as Lucky Forward?
A fuck you.
Correct response. Robert, what author won the Pulitzer Prize in 1945 for his novel The Belle of Adano?
Ernest Hemingway.
John Hersey. Charles, who became the first human to break the sound barrier while piloting the Bell X-1 experimental plane?
Blow me.
Correct. Gerard, the Liberty Bell cracked in 1835 while tolling and mourning the death of what former government official?
John Jay.
I believe your pig ignorance and following the rules of the game will prevent you from winning the money. Goodbye.
Oh, yeah? Well, then sit on my face, bitch.
Correct response. I will officially put you back into the game, Gerard. Lucky you. Last chance to prove yourself, we go to Richard. Richard, what animal did Lewis Carroll's Mad Hatter insert into the poem Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star?
Gee, I don't know, Anne, but hey, insert this.
Richard, congratulations. By virtue of your male chauvinist flippant response, you are the biggest thing.
Hey, what can I say but eat me?
544-560 WQM. Speaking of eating things, by the way, here's a fax I received early this morning. I want to thank Diana, the weight manager. Well, that's the name of the place. But the answer is
no.
No. Subject, lose the weight and keep it off. She says, I know it's very difficult to lose weight and keep it off, and that's why I would like to introduce you to my company, the Weight Manager. Our plans involve no shots, no pills, and for that matter, no gimmicks. And the answer is still
no.
No. You notice that word keeps popping up here?
No.
No. We require your cooperation in changing your eating habits so we can help you make the right food choices. Now, I started reading this morning, and then I got to this part, and that's kind of like, it says, our plans are based on the food pyramid so you can make the right choices while eating at home or eating out at your favorite restaurants or maybe going to a
party. Yeah.
We provide motivational support and constant follow-up with you so we can help assure your weight management success. Now, does that part sound like the same old, yeah. We'd like to provide you a complimentary weight loss plan.
No.
We're conveniently located in Plantation.
No.
And please contact us at your earliest convenience at 954-yada-yada-yada.
No.
So we can start managing it together. It.
No.
No. Thanks anyway, Diana, and then I'll give you a nice free plug. Also, hablamos español, it says at the bottom. No se habla español aquí.
Yeah, but do they speak Yiddish?
No pique de pani. Huh? Caxo hois. Hubman Dreard. 5670560 pound five. No, it's not, don't take that personal, Diane. I didn't mean for you. I'm just teaching George some Yiddish.
She doesn't know what you said.
Oh. How do you know? There's probably Jews over there. It's a weight loss thing. Hey, Jews are big on weight loss. And the good news we had the other day while you were up there in, what you call it, in Tennessee, is guess who's still alive?
Get the honey, Junior.
He's very much still
alive.
That. Oh, I thought he was dead. So that was reassuring news. It's not, we're always reading about all these celebrities who died, and we get very, you know, sad about it for 5 minutes. Not much we can do about it. But once in a while, you get good news. He's still alive.
Get the honey, Junior.
Oscar Lapidus? No, Oscar Lapidus was your Sonny LaPalana?
Right.
I get him confused.
I don't know who played who. I think Richie Caron was Oscar Lapidus.
Was he?
Yes.
No. Sonny LaPalata.
Well, I said Sonny LaPalata, and then somebody called up and said, no, you
well,
got
been
it wrong.
So, it's been so long since I saw the goddamn movie.
Yeah,
exactly. Somebody will know. Some expert on fatso. Some fatso expert out there.
You ain't the only!
Here's a mobile in North Miami Beach. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, how you doing?
Great.
The one thing that concerns me about this stadium deal...
And what is that?
Garoya and Fingerhead... They're going to arrange it so that they vote the thing up or down probably during the summer.
When in July. July.
Mostly morons were here.
Uh-huh.
So there's no telling.
They're
going to
have another special election in July like they did with the penny sales tax that on the gas, the whatever that was, the roads that Pinga Pequena tried 2 summers ago.
Right. That's the exact same formula.
And they probably figure they can pull it off in July this year because I won't be here this July. That was 2 years ago I was here. I won't be here.
Yeah, well, anyway, that's what concerns me, so we'll keep an eye on it. Listen, on this Brazill thing, do you think the guy should be tried as an adult or in juvenile court?
Adult.
Yeah, me too, because Randy's just freaking out. She's like,
Well, let me ask you something. When you're talking about a bleeding heart liberal like that bitch, who cares whether she's freaking out? Have a great day, pal. Not interested in what she's thinking. Are you interested in what she's thinking?
No.
No. She's freaking out. She's freaking ridiculous. 5670560. She's just freaking. Pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. I mean, you lemmings out there that want to be led down the garden path by some of these professional au jean provocateur wannabe talk show hosts, I feel sorry for you. Some of you professional yentas out there, some of you light bulb people. Life isn't a talk show, okay, sir? This is a talk show. This is my life. This is, no, it's not my life. This is my occupation. This is what I do to make a couple of bucks.
Associated with a volcano.
Oh, okay.
Things associated with a volcano.
Squirt, squirt.
Ready. Go.
Peter North.
The place, the islands where there's one going now.
Hawaii.
Hawaii.
Mm-hmm. Not cold,
cold, but
hot.
Mm-hmm. The stuff
what
that flows out of
it.
Uh-huh. The one up in Washington.
Mount St. Helens.
Mm-hmm. These are left over in a fire at the bottom of fireplace.
Ashes.
Uh-huh. What it does, it
erupts.
Mm-hmm. And it's
like
a national.
This place.
When it happens, it's a
calamity.
Another word.
Disaster.
Yes.
This place. You got that right away. Nice going there. One of the great shows in the history of mankind. Nobody doesn't like Pyramid. If you don't like the Pyramid, then you're, and I'll tell you right now, you're an asshole. Okay? I don't want to start playing Butch Boss with you and telling you what to like and what not to like. But if you don't like that show, you're a major, major asshole. You're breathing a lot of air that somebody useful could be breathing. Just keep that in mind. Don't take it personal unless you want to. It's a great show. Not a good show. It's a great show. Not as good as Passions, though. That's because Miguel's not on there. Here's a Mobile in Hallandale, or Timmy. Mobile in Hallandale.
Hey, how you doing, Neil?
Okay, sir.
I was talking on the stadium issue.
Yes.
I don't think they need it. I wouldn't give it to them. They can't have my money for it.
Yeah.
But the way I called Nathan Brazill, I think it should be tried as an adult. You see all the posters, 10, 20 life, but yet nobody seems accountable for their actions. They do what they want to do, and then it comes to, well, he's a minor. Well, he didn't know. Well, and it's always some sort of excuse, and nobody can say something. He's on video. He saw him. He pulled the trigger. He shot the guy in the head.
Mm-hmm.
He's guilty.
Mm-hmm.
What's, you know, why is there any debate over a lot of these people?
Because we have a lot of bleeding hearts out there who don't want to make people accountable for what they do. And, of course, and those people do such irreparable damage because every time that they start bleeding with a baloney here, just like Robert Steinbeck, it, like, sends a message out there that, we'll get behind you. We'll get you off next time. Go ahead and do it.
Yeah. Not only should he be accountable, wherever he got the gun should also be held accountable.
Right. Amen. Okay. F and A. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T. And do you ever see the 666 on, now that Carlos got his hair cut, you see the 666 on his forehead?
No.
Yeah. He's the Antichrist. Here's a Mobile in Palm Beach. Hello.
Hey, you know, the Herald used to employ a pretty good black writer by the name of B.L. Hines. I don't know if you remember her or not. She used to write really wholesome columns.
Yeah, a long time ago. Huh?
And I guess she just didn't...
What do you mean? What do you mean by wholesome? What does that mean? Wholesome? Sir! What does that mean, wholesome columns? What does that mean?
She used to write, you know, nothing controversial, nothing ethnic, nothing slanted, nothing racial.
Well, what's wrong with writing something controversial? I don't want to read mamby-pamby. There's nothing wrong with being controversial, but writing this swill that he wrote today, this is garbage.
But even when the issue is clearly, I hate to say anti-black, but I will, he still sides on his own behalf.
The issue is black? This is a black and white issue here?
He always seems to make it that way, him and Pitch.
Yeah.
Letter's another one.
Right. And have a great day. See, he doesn't understand it. There's nothing wrong with having somebody writing about something of substance as opposed to a puff column, which I don't want to read puff columns, but at least write something that makes sense. See, the guy's got it like part right. He just didn't... Did he express himself well?
No.
No, there's that word again. No. He's all over the place. All over the road. Kind of like the music on the coast. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless Line. 72 votes. Not a very good poll question, I apologize, but Eric is busy eating all day today. Well, no, he had to take one day out of his very busy schedule. He had to take a weekday, and in order to maintain that gigantic girth of his, he had to go on an eating seminar from a breakfast till late night snack. And so he took about 5 minutes out to, like, flip this thing up, and that's it. 5 minutes out to flip it. And then, of course, he'll be spending much time eliminating. Because when you eat nonstop, wow. 72 votes. Do you think that most Americans take responsibility for their own actions? 77 votes now. Yes, 65. What is it? I mean, no 65, thank God. And yes, 12.
I want to give you a kiss.
Wow. 12 people say yes, they take responsibility for their own actions. Or maybe what they mean is 12 people in America take responsibility for their own actions. That's it. We haven't found those 12 yet, but we're looking for them. Here's Homestead. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Question. Did you see the article in the Herald today that John Bobbitt wants to get that knife that was used and auction it off?
No.
Yeah, it was in the second page of the Herald. Apparently they're holding it in the courthouse.
They're holding it?
In the courthouse. Yeah, mm-hmm. The knife, too.
Oh, I see.
Also, no phone service on Sunday for Cuba.
Yeah.
Fidel's cutting it off.
And? Well, maybe he borrowed the knife. Well, it's really amazing the things that really turn some of you people on, like I said before. Wow, 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 wow. Woo! Like that fax about Stephen King is buying some mansion in Sarasota or something. Who cares? Somebody wastes a perfectly good sheet of my fax paper to fax me that there's a rumor Stephen King is buying a $9 million mansion somewhere by Sarasota. Well, why does anybody care? Do I care about Stephen King?
No.
Where he lives?
No.
How much his place costs?
No.
Get a life. Get a freaking life. And have a nice day. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T. And Verizon Wireless line. Oh, we're going for the 25,000. There we go.
Rub down. We have
give it a rub down, Dick.
I'm going to ask everybody to be nice and quiet. There is no time. Quiet, please. Thank
quiet,
you.
Please. Come up.
Here's your first subject.
Go.
Go.
The campus.
Classrooms.
Professors. Well,
things in a school. Things in a
campus.
University. Things in a part of a college.
I think that I'll talk to my friends here in the 50s in this television show. I'll wear my black leather jacket.
What
I'm a teen idol.
What Fonzie would say, you dumb bitch.
What Fonzie might say.
There you go. Wasting a lot of valuable time.
La Traviata. Aida.
Good. Nice going. I made up for it. Here we go.
Jack-o'-lantern.
Black
things
cat.
Things associated with Halloween.
Right. Costume. That's it.
My lips.
Pat Boone.
Your lips.
Things that are
birds.
Red. Things
tea
that
kettles.
Are. Things that whistle.
Peapots. There you go. There's the one. Here we go for the big money.
Blonde
never get
hair. Dirty clothing.
Things that are bleached.
Ah! Woo! There you go. 25 grand. Not bad. 5670560. You didn't find that exciting? I find it fascinating. You were what?
Somebody was hawking me a China on the
about
phone.
What?
About nothing of consequence.
Oh. I've had a lot of those. Here's line four somewhere. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
I've been sitting here listening to this for a couple of days about the stadium, and it hit me like a ton of bricks.
Really?
There will be no stadium. I think it's a Bush ballet between Jeb and George W. and John Henry. They're going to piss off the people down here. They're going to say there's not going to be a stadium. John Henry's going to move the team to Washington, and baseball's fair-haired boy from Texas,
no.
George W.
They're not moving to Washington. The Orioles won't permit it. It's not going to happen.
Oh, I don't know.
Let me say it again, sir. It's not going to happen. Read my lips. It is not going to happen. Is it going to happen?
No.
No. 5670 5. I mean, talk about convoluted logic. Somehow now we got the Bush boys, and I have no love for either one of them, as you know. But now the Bush boys are responsible that nobody goes to baseball games down here, and John Henry made a bad deal with Wayne. I mean, you talk about really stretching it. Man, that thing's going to break pretty soon, pal, if you don't stop stretching it. God. Talk about lack of logic, lack of common sense. But he's been thinking about it long and hard, and, yeah. Wow. Give it your best shot. Come on, here we go. 5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. 4 minutes till noon at 2 a.m. Where are the bargains? I'll tell you where they are. I'll tell you where to go. The bargains are at the swap shop over 88 acres. Good news and bad news. The good news is somebody sent me my own remote-controlled fart machine. The bad news is it doesn't have any batteries in it. We got a remote-controlled fart machine.
What size batteries?
I don't know, because it's got a screw-down thing with like a little tiny Phillips head. You got a tiny little Phillips head? Here's my... And the interesting part of it is, even though there's no batteries, when I press the button on the remote, all the lights blinked again in here. Remember like it did before? Yeah. Watch. Oh, geez. There you go. Well, don't take my remote control. Don't be taking that whole thing out of here, because I know you.
Yeah.
I'll never see it again. God. And we got another letter from Richard Molinari. You know, Richard, I'm doing the best I can for you, but don't be a chronic. Didn't we spend a lot of time on him yesterday trying desperately to get this poor bastard a job, the Miami Fanatic? Wait till you see these pictures. And Richard sends me another letter today saying, hello, how are you? I wanted to write and say a very big thank you for talking about me on your show Tuesday, May 8th, as in yesterday. So we didn't waste any time. Here it is, Wednesday, May 9th, just 1 week before we're going to execute Tim McVeigh. And here's another letter from Richard Molinari. and another card from the Miami Fanatic. I had several people mention to me they heard about me on your show. I'll let you know as soon as I get a job. No, that's okay, Dick. Good luck to you. And here's another page. Hopefully that'll be real soon because standing on the concrete sidewalk 4 hours each day causes my knees and back to wake. Say hello to George R. for me. Hello, George R.
What?
From Richard Molinari, the Miami Fanatic.
Oh, yeah.
You know him?
When I used to do those remotes with Rick Weaver out at the stadium, he was
Rick
always
Weaver?
There. You remember Rick Weaver? Reaver?
He used to do remotes with Rick Weaver?
Remember when Gary Bruce was trying to get me to quit by assigning me double duty and sports talk remotes twice a week and driving the van around and setting up equipment?
The fans beginning to blow the play selection.
They're blowing the play selection, yeah.
Anyway, he was always there at the stadium.
Where is he now?
He is on Queer Street right now.
Oh. Well, anyway, he says to say hi to George. And there's another page that says, if I can ever be of any help by showing up at one of your charity fundraisers, I'd be glad to do so.
No.
Oh, no, thanks,
no.
Richard.
No.
No, thank you. Also, know how to get people to dig deeper in their pockets for charity. No, thanks,
no.
Dick, but good luck to you. And stop writing me so many letters. He's a good guy. We wish him all the best in the world. Miguel said he's a good guy. George said he's okay. Never stole a freight train. So how's our fart machine coming? We got batteries yet?
They took my pack of batteries and the fart machine out of here, so I don't know.
Oh, so they're working on it right now? And it says it's advertised in the Howard Sperm Show. How do you like that?
I've only got AAA batteries. I hope those are the right.
It says newer, louder, realistic farts. Louder is the way. Yeah, and more realistic.
We already have one, though.
Like, we
those.
Do?
Yeah, it's in the cabinet somewhere.
We have a fart machine?
Same exact kind.
And it's not good?
Sure it's good.
Oh.
We had one back at IOD, the old building.
Oh, this is from Long Arms. Oh, so it's not from Murmur because he's Short Arms, whoever Long Arms. Do we know who Long Arms is? I have no idea. It says, you have a great show. I listen to it every day while I work. Heard you talking about the remote control fart machine, so I'm sending you one so you can try it out on Hank.
Hey, press the remote. It's over there. I put it way over there.
Ah, jeez. Holy crap. Oh, give me my thing now. Thank you. That's pretty good.
Different farting sound. I don't know about better.
Oh, this would be great on an elevator, don't you think? Oh, yeah, that would be great on our elevator. People are already peeing in their pants that they're not going to make it back to the first floor on that thing. And they're usually probably right. Oh, this is great. You mean we've got one in the cabinet and we haven't made great use of this? This would have come in tremendously handy yesterday.
We ran the batteries out of it. You don't remember?
We did?
We put it behind
Rick kind of ran out of gas, you might say?
You press the button from the other
room. That's beautiful. And it's got a remote control button. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Are you pressing the button in there? Because this one is just farting spontaneously now. Oh, no. Interchangeable remotes. Okay, there you go. Great.
And I'm sure when we get the batteries in this one.
Yeah. Get those batteries hooked up in there, and I'll be, we can have our own farting contest. This is sensational. So thanks a lot, Long Arms. Oh, I see. If anybody else is interested, I see. Here's somebody who sells them. I thought it was somebody just being nice and bought us one.
Is Hank in the building today?
Yeah, I guess so. It sounds like Hank. Hey, listen, after the stuff he said yesterday about waffling on that ballpark thing,
I'm just thinking, since we have an extra one.
The verdict is out on Fatso, I'll tell you that. He got me crazy yesterday with that, you know, waxing poetic about, baseball, and they got a nice young team, and yeah, big deal. That and 40 cents will buy half a cup of coffee, okay? About a quarter of a bagel. If anyone's interested and says, I sell them on eBay for $9.95 each, my eBay ID is, Long Arms. Or they can
contest testing on.
That's great. Now, is yours hooked up?
Yes.
Oh. Oh, now the best part of it is it works in stereo when you get that one hooked up. Here we go. Great. But the best part of it also is they're not doing the same one. Beauty. I like that. So it's like a twin holer kind of, like the old days.
Uh-huh.
Man. Anyone can buy one on, look at that, Carlito 1. They're not going to do that. Carlito 1. I can't even read this. Carlito 1 at prodigy.net. I don't know. His eBay ID is Long Arms. That's the best bet. They're $9.95. And well worth it at twice the price, I'd say. Yeah, they got a remote control. It's advertised on the highly listened to Howard Sperm Show. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Here's a call in Perrine. Hello.
Hello. Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Great.
First time caller.
All right.
Listen, the only thing I have a disagreement with you is the Motown sound. You constantly, this is the second time you said that black people didn't listen to
it. Well, all I can tell you, now, how old are you?
49.
Well, then you should know, because when I was in Detroit, the deal was they always used to say that Motown was for black music for white people and that black folks listened to, like, James Brown and all kinds of other stuff.
No, well, I don't know about them, but in Cleveland, did you spend any time in Cleveland?
As little as possible.
Oh, okay.
I did once go to Northfield Downs in Cleveland. We lost the ranch, and that was it. And I also went to a Browns-Giants football game in 1960. That was the end of it.
Well, Motown used to come through Cleveland a lot at the different Motown Review and stuff.
No wonder they went out of business, yeah.
Right, and but Motown was our sound. It was the sound, because those are the only things today and still know the words as being sung.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I agree with you on
that. Well, I feel a lot better knowing that dark folks like Motown. It's a lot better than hip-hop crap, I'll tell you that.
Right, right. And Destiny Child, those songs won't last past a year. You won't even know the words.
Thank God.
And as far as chicken go, which place we like to eat at?
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. We just love chicken. We love boiled, fried, and we even love jerk chicken.
Jerk chicken, yeah.
That's right. So, you know, there's no choice of where we go to eat chicken.
How about jerk pork?
You could probably get some in this neighborhood.
Yeah, we're in Little Jamaica here. We can probably get some good jerk chicken for you.
Yeah. Oh,
you know,
okay.
You put lime juice on that?
What, lime juice on jerk chicken?
Mm-hmm.
No, it's a seasoning that you buy. It's a Jamaican seasoning. They're the one, the Caribbean seasoning, rather. And you rub it all over the chicken and stick it in the oven, and it tastes good. But if you don't like...
Now, what about watermelon?
What about watermelon?
Don't you love
it? It's on the top of the list.
There you go.
Black people should never say that watermelon. Remember that time they ran the ad in the front of the page or something, advertisement, they had a black person eating a watermelon?
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't offended by that because I love watermelon. When the season, I look for the season every year to begin, so I can buy me a nice big watermelon. It tastes good.
And it also comes in handy for a jerking pork, too. Have a great day, pal.
Bye.
Yeah, did you ever jerk pork with a watermelon? 567-0560-560. On the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. This thing is just astonishing. Oh, yeah. Just when you think they're done, sometimes it's like a second, they get a second wind. Stereo. Boy, too bad. I'm a survivor, but now there's a reason to keep on surviving until next season. I'm a survivor. I cannot take it. Call 14 at 560 WQAM. Here's a fax, and look at this. They're all stealing it now. And you'll never guess what Castor Nova did yesterday morning. Monday we did farts because we got this great CD. I'm about to pull my finger. So anyway, yesterday morning, Castor Nova's doing a fart show. And Dan LeBastard writes and says, I have a feeling he listens to your show. 20 questions with Marlins catcher Charles Johnson. CJ. This is from Dan LeBastard. You have to have a funny story over the years about someone breaking wind in the batter's box. How do you like that? How Dan LeBastard is farting in the Herald. See, Neil farts once and all of a sudden, they're farting all over town. Just like that. 125 votes on a poll. Do you think that most Americans take responsibility for their own actions? 19, yes. No, 106. 106, 85% say no.
No.
And that's the correct answer, of course. Here's another fact. It says, I know you're always wondering if some people are still alive or some have died. This website might help. Thank you, Jonathan and the Gables. www.whosaliveandwhosdead.com. That's cute. Well, that must cover a lot of territory. www.whosaliveandwhosdead.com. I wonder if our friend is on there. Sonny LaPolana. He's alive. They hit him with 5 pizza pies and he's still alive. Here's a mobile in Miami. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, sir.
I'm a big baseball fan and a Marlins fan.
Uh-huh.
And I go to a game very occasionally as the season goes on and it gets hot and the rains become more unpredictable. It'll be less and less.
Uh-huh.
But what I don't understand doesn't seem to come out. You hear this guy, Henry, expects me to drive like an hour and a half because I got to go through the rush hour to get there. And all these complaints and everything, some legitimate that these people have.
Why should I leave my house when I can watch it for here for basically for free? And not only that, but I get to see plenty of other baseball games. I mean, they're giving it to me for basically free, and then he's saying, you know, come through the hassle, spend all your money, and come here.
No,
and
no, see, you're missing the point. He doesn't care where they build it. I mean, he would have preferred Bicentennial Park because he might have actually been successful there, but in his mind, anyway. But he doesn't care as long as somebody will build it for him.
No, I understand that, but I'm a baseball fan, and I don't even support it because of the fact that most of the time during the week, I'm not going to go, period, for the game. I'm going to watch it here. Nobody seems to bring out the fact that, you know, maybe a lot of people follow the Marlins and watch the games, but they're not going to go out to the ballpark no matter where he goes.
But a lot of people don't watch the Marlins and follow the games. Their TV ratings are abysmal. They're minuscule.
How many people do, you probably would know, how many people watch a Marlins game on TV?
None.
No, seriously.
I have no idea what the
number is. More than are in the stadium, I bet, right?
Well, probably.
Yeah, so, all these games are going corporate. It's like that movie Rollerball, you know. It's not about who's there or anything unless it's corporate people. It's about, you know, TV. And pretty soon he'll get smart and they'll start either blacking out games or start charging.
If they blacked out every game, it isn't going to make a bit of difference.
You're probably right. People still wouldn't go out. They'd just start paying more to watch it on satellite if they wanted it.
You're missing the point. Most people don't care. Don't you get it? The number of people are watching you could a phone booth and have room for the Chinese army. Most people don't care. You just can't get that through your mind.
That's true. That's the other thing. This is not a Major League Baseball town.
It's not a Major League anything town. It's not. I don't know what you're laughing about. It's not.
The Dolphins do pretty well.
The Dolphins do well. The Dolphins is like it's been here for 35 years, okay? That's the one thing. They go there to tailgate and to get drunk. You know, it's a redneck thing. That's why it does well here.
Plus, it's only once a week.
Right, that's right.
And it's on Sunday.
And it's only 8 times a year.
Yeah, so John Henry, you know, do whatever you want. It makes no difference to me. No matter what you do, I'm going to watch baseball either way, so it's no skin off my ass.
Okay, thanks.
Take care.
Well, that was good timing. Wasn't that beautiful?
Uh-huh.
Wow. Thanks for the good talk-up. 567-0560, #560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Here's Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Well, this is a voice from the past. This is Everett Alley. I was on your show one time with Madeline Murray O'Hare.
Wow.
That is going back, huh?
Uh-huh.
Something new.
How's she doing, by the way? She's still dead?
She's still dead.
Oh, okay. Yep. That's what I'm hearing.
That is a doornail.
Mm-hmm.
I say this is new.
Oh, and
it was also new about 12 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And that is, it says nobody will touch it. Great story, but nobody will touch it.
Yeah.
And that is the discovery of the factual nature of existence.
The factual nature of existence?
Yep.
What does that mean?
The scientific discovery of the factual nature of existence.
The factual nature of existence, yes?
Yes, indeed.
Uh-huh.
But the problem is, it messes up everything else.
But what is the scientific story of the factual, whatever you said?
Okay, the quantum physics bumped into a brick wall back in about 1890.
Uh-huh.
And so, come along 50 years later, this engineer from General Electric recognized that he had to have an uninvasive means of approaching fundamental physics. Physics at the level of the formation of structure.
Mm-hmm.
So he approached it on the basis of motion. So we have a new system, and it works. It's both.
It
puts the motion in the basket, yeah.
And
Listen, what are you talking about? Why don't you condense this to something that the average moron can understand like us? What are you talking about?
Well, nature doesn't care about the average moron. It doesn't care about much of anything.
Yeah, well, that's what we're talking to, morons like me.
That's about it.
See, if you're going to have a conversation and it's going to be meaningful, you have to explain it in terms that we can understand.
Okay.
Otherwise, it just comes across as double talk, which is what it sounds like to me.
All right. The new system shows...
The new system.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
That's what this is.
This
new physics system shows that existence is a continuum based on motion.
Yeah.
And so it goes on and on. There's no beginning. There's no creation.
Yeah.
There's no end point.
Well, that's nothing new. That's just a concept of infinity. There's nothing new about that.
Yeah, but this is the first time that there's scientific proof of it.
Yeah.
This is the thing.
Mm-hmm.
this is something that can't be refuted.
Mm-hmm.
So, but well, none of the media will touch it.
No, of course not. It's not good for business, so don't make any waves. Okay?
There you go.
Okay.
There you go.
Say hi to Madeline and John, by the way.
Pardon?
I say have a great day. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. It's undulating. It's moving and it's rolling and it's ongoing and it's infinite and it's gigantic and vivid and massive, as Rick Riley would say. That make any sense to you, what he was just hawking at China about?
What?
567-0560, pound 560 on, and he was on my show years ago. What does that tell you?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. That's the kind of shows I used to do, and I'm still apologizing for them. Not to the audience, to myself. I might still have some gray matter left up there if it weren't for those shows. How about Holy Joe? Come on, Holy Joe! Holy Joe! All those other getchkies I used to put on the air was fun in its day, you know? They had their moments. All the rabbis, the rabbi with Jerry Wichner's gun in his head, all of these things. Speaking of Jerry Wichner, how's he doing?
He died.
Here's Miami. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
How you doing today, sir?
Okay.
Listen, your poll question is very suitable for today's topic. I think it's going to be all over the news later on today about this kid on trial.
Mm-hmm.
But the one thing I
nobody
want to
seems
out...
to want to talk about the kid on trial. I read that whole article by Robert Steinbeck, that unctuous commentary that he wrote, and I had a little bit of the audio from his testimony on here, and nobody wants to talk about it.
I see that, and its reason is, I guess the kid is already proven his point, and he is guilty. Also, this point is that I was killing time while I was listening to you. Before you came on this morning.
Yeah.
And they did use the F
right,
word.
Right, I heard that.
On the
CNN.
Station over there.
Right.
But if you missed bits and pieces of it, the kid did know what he was doing. He did say, I pulled the trigger. The kid
right. And when they asked him to show how to demonstrate how it could go off accidentally, he couldn't do it.
Exactly.
They gave him every chance. I saw that. They gave him every chance in the world. They put the gun in his hand. And how does this thing go off accidentally? And he couldn't do it.
I don't know.
Because it can't, and it won't.
Yeah, I understand. All right, Neil, have a good day.
And you too.
Take care.
Okay, let's see. Enrique writes, this really gets me pissed off. On the ballots during the presidential election, there was a section to vote for some new train at a... No. They were talking about that bullet train. That was just theoretical. That was just, would you like it? Well, what is this all about? Also, I'm not against the new stadium provided it's out of John Henry or baseball players' pockets. Okay, that's good. I'm a fan of final load. I'm a white Julio, 31 years old, who eats watermelon.
Oh.
Do Julios eat watermelon? Well, everybody likes watermelon.
I don't know anybody who doesn't.
I'm not just saying that dark folks eat watermelon, but that's part of their signature is, you know, after they do the crime, they leave the pits. And Lee. Now, come on. That's bad. Now, seriously. If you do the, isn't that what Johnny Cochran says? If you do the crime, leave the pits?
Uh-huh.
Something like that. Or spit them out. When in doubt, spit them out. And it says, I read this on the web today and it pissed me off. Comes the day after the judge ruled to admit the 911 tapes that referred to a wrong-way driver on I-95. The judge has yet to rule on whether he'll permit the following evidence in the trial of David Farrell. Damaging comments made to an FHP patrolman the night of the crash, which includes visual recreation of the accident. He says, what the F were you doing on the wrong side of a well-known expressway at that time if you weren't drunk? Excellent question there, Enrique. Excellent question. You know, he went through that sobriety thing and he drank the booze. Oh, great. See, to me, that's worse. That makes it even worse. If you weren't drunk, what kind of a sober FHP or any other human being are you driving on the wrong side of the road, killing that poor Schwarzer? In closing, he says, Nathaniel Brazill and the punky kid that killed his sister during the extreme wrestling practice should be fried. No offense, this is my personal feeling. They knew exactly what can seriously hurt anyone by their actions, etc. and so on. And he says, what happened to the cops caught a prostitution ring? Not much. Little slap on the wrist and not much. No headline, no big story, because it's not a big deal in this town. Well, the guy cussing about A-Rod and make a million. 1 to 2 hour, please. Okay, you got it, Enrique. You got it. And by the way, no extra charge. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T line. Yeah, I'm watching Richard Dawson.
You had a few people singing together. In other words, singing more than two, you said a quartet. Survey said.
Oh, they got it. 182, baby. Next one, they're going over the top. 182.
Trio, number one answer.
Yeah. Come on, let's get to it.
Occupation associated with cars.
He's no Lou, what's his name? Was it Louis Anderson?
Car wash, that's a good one. 18 points for $5,000.
Yeah, let's go. Come on.
He added to all that loot you had.
Quit dicking around.
Survey said.
Oh. Zero.
Mechanic.
Yeah. Some of the answers that they come up with on this show are just mind-blowing.
Boring pet, you said. Cat.
Yeah, cat's got to be number one.
What you need, survey said.
Five. Only five? How about a bird?
Okay.
Bird, number one.
Let's see, fish was number one,
what
by the way.
What is it, fish?
Graduation gift. You said you'd let him watch.
How about a turtle?
Did you say? Well, is that what all you said? Bad. Watch. Yeah. I guess that wouldn't be bad. Not a lasting gift, but what the hell? A bit of excitement, that's what we
come
need.
Come on, get it over with already.
13 points for $5,000. Survey said.
29. Okay. 27.
Laser.com, the new laser institute located at 4300 West Oakland Park Boulevard in Fort Lauderdale. You too will see why you'll be saying thank you, Dr. Panu.
All your play-by-play is right here.
Murray scores!
Sports Radio 560 QAM.
WQM. So anyway, Freddie in Bimini, you know that chronic Schwarzer in the Bahamas?
No.
That keeps faxing? Oh, yeah, he faxed last week a couple of times. He's okay. He's just a chronic and he's an idiot. He says, finally, someone got it right. He was right on and you just missed the call about Bush in South Florida, about the conspiracy, the Bushes. I mean, come on. Come on, Freddie. And then another fax from Freddie who can't control himself.
Yeah,
once he starts with one, it'll come spewing out. You know what I mean? And the faxes, too. Wait till you hear this to show you how out of the loop Freddie is. Do you remember, have you ever heard the farting contest? It was at least 40 years ago I heard it. And he goes on to describe it about the announcer describing the contestants. Freddie, we've only been playing that on this show for about the last 600 years during the holidays when we have a lot of time to play it because it's a long thing and we want to play it uninterrupted when we got no commercials. We've only been playing that every year for the last 600 years on this show, Freddie. So get with it, will you?
Yeah, man.
Good. And by the way, Freddie... 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Oh, these things are sensational. Can you imagine all the great places this would come in handy? Just like the places we mentioned the other day in that poll on Monday. We took a poll on the most embarrassing place you've ever farted in your life. Church was one of them.
Or graduation at a Bible college.
Or like job interview. Yeah. Yeah, like if you got somebody else coming in to interview for your job and you don't want to get it, just like put it under the chair where they're going to be sitting. Oh, I don't think so. I just realized I got another appointment. School would be good. Maybe put it under Nathaniel's desk. Of course, he might not like that. Uh-oh.
Put it under the stand while he's testifying.
Yeah, put it under the stand while Nathaniel's testing. He'd be testifying. Yeah. Judge would call an instant recess, probably. Think so?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Just think of all the nifty, and a car would be good. Yeah. On the plane. Under your seat on the plane on a long transatlantic flight. Oh, payback is a bitch, baby. Yeah. In fact, the next time I get one of those ass-in-your-face guys in the business class that wants to bend over and talk to his buddy for half hour and sticking his ass in your face, one of those big, fat Dutchmen like that one trip back, I'll just... Oh. Yeah. Excellent. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon. How about at a wedding would be good? On your honeymoon night? Yeah. Here's Aventura. Hello.
Yeah, how about a funeral, Neil?
Yeah, that would be good.
Uh-huh. Hey, listen, I got a good idea of how to fill that baseball stadium.
Yeah.
If they legalize cockfights and show them between the innings.
Uh-huh, that might do it.
You would fill that joint.
Cockfights in between alternate innings and strip shows would be good.
That would guarantee to fill it.
Uh-huh.
On a serious note.
Yes, sir.
how do you regard Mike Lang as a hockey announcer?
He used to be great, and unfortunately, for whatever reason, I know he's had some contractual problems with Fox. You know, are you talking about last night's game?
Well, no, I've heard him on a number of occasions, and I mean, he puts a lot of silliness into his...
But I mean, that's his shtick. But Mike used to be one of my very favorites, but lately he's really slipped a few notches. And last night, I was watching, I didn't think it was blacked out on the big on the small dish. And last night, I guess because it went into overtime, and they have it on a timer, The overtime was on, and I'm pretty dismayed with his performance the last two seasons. He's still entertaining, but not what he used to be.
He
doesn't seem to be into it anymore, yeah. I guess.
Well, you're like old wine, and he's not.
Okay.
Thanks, Neil.
Okay, and by the way, Mike sends a message for him. I mean, he's a good guy, Mike. I like him, and he's a friend. And now somebody will say, oh, yeah, Neil Rogers ripped you, you know. I'm not ripping him. I'm just saying he just, the last couple of seasons, doesn't seem to be up to his usual brilliant self. Like that winning goal I played before by Straka last night. He almost blew the call. And then he's got Eddie Olczyk laughing like a... Yeah, got a lot of hockey fans down here, don't we?
No.
Oh, boy. A lot of baseball fans?
No.
Yeah, well, the guy made a good point before. The reason there's so many people at the air show, number one, it was outdoors. I take that back. Number two, it was outdoors. Number one, it was free. That's the main reason. It's free. Go to the beach. It was a nice sunny day, and you go see a bunch of crap, and they put on a show for you. And even if you're not interested, it was free. Even Joe Costello was over there. Why? Because he lives over there, he said. If you lived out by me, would you go on to the air show? And he said, no chance. No way, Jose. And I said, what about you, Jose? And he said, okay. Here's Miami. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello, Neil.
How you doing?
Good, thank you. I wanted to comment on a piece done by Peter Jennings on Monday night about genocide in the Congo.
In the condos? Yeah.
In the Congo, where two militiamen were swinging a human jump rope at the edge of a bridge about 100 foot high.
Yeah.
And swung him over the bridge. When he landed in the shallow water, he was still alive, and the militiamen started shooting at him with what appeared to be M16 rifles.
Wow, sounds like what we did in Vietnam to all those civilians.
That was incredible.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was a horrible experience, being used as a human jump rope, being tossed over, you know, a bridge.
Yeah. This, you know something, this probably would have come handy then, too. Oh, gee, just went over the bridge. Well, hey, listen, you can't blame him, can you? I probably would. 567-0560, #560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. This has just opened up a whole new avenue, if you pardon that expression. Wow. These are explosive. Right. As opposed to, yeah, the old stale ones that you're used to, like the stale ones on the airplane.
Uh-huh.
Mixed in with that musty charcoal. 21 till noon. Speaking of stale and musty, your carpets may be just like that if you haven't had them cleaned recently. If you'd like to get them smelling just like brand new, I mean lemony fresh and looking like new, Dry Concepts are the folks who can do it. They're miracle workers. This is about the only miracle I believe in the world, and that's Dry Concepts. Because I've had them in my home for about 20 years now, and every year they come in and clean my schmutzy, marginal-looking carpets and make them look just like I had brand-new carpeting laid on the floor. And, of course, while they're doing the cleaning, they apply disinfectant at no extra charge, and that's why when they finish, your carpets do smell like a Mahaya, lemony fresh. And they give you a written guaranteed price right up front, before they touch a thing, before they start doing the job. Here's what it's going to cost you. No rip-offs, no tack-ons, a stupendous $10.50 in Toronto. Anybody here know what that is?
No.
Wait till you hear this. 64 jailed as mommy date cops break up a cockfighting ring.
Boy!
Oh, I'm sorry, break up a fighting ring. Police raided a cockfighting ring operated in sparsely populated northwest Miami-Dade County, confiscating 18 roosters, $23,000, and arresting 64 people. What are they going to do with all those cocks? One man was charged with operating... Eat them. Illegal cockfights, a felony. Two others were charged with felony cocaine possession. And cocaine? Oh, no. Not only are they operating cockfights, but they're snorting and blowing, too. And 61 others were charged with taking part in illegal cockfighting, a misdemeanor, according to a release issued by the Miami-Dade Police Department. The cocks were confiscated by the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, police said. A list of the names arrested in Monday's raid was not immediately available for release. Detective Vanessa Cook said today. How do you not? Saturday night, the cockfight sounds appropriate to us, don't it? Do we have that in here?
Yes.
Haven't played that in a cool stage. Huh?
Sabado night.
Oh, Sabado, it's a spick thing, I see. We don't now see, are they going to get upset just like the blacks with the watermelons? I sure hope not.
We make fun of them, too.
Oh, yeah. How about watermelon night?
Well, cockfight. Sabado night, around New Haven O'clock.
I'll tell you where I'm gonna go. Cruising in my 80 Chevy lowrider truck to join the other Julios. I have cages in the back where I carry my cock. You can hear them cock-a-doodle-doo. And if I kill one or kill them, all depends on if I win or lose.
Have a good night at the cockfight. Who cares what gringos may be?
When you're subliterate and Latin, then barbaric is the way to be. Well, there's Jorge and Rolando and Julio, whose cocks look pretty good.
Yes.
In the arena, you can see the pectorino rolls growing stiff as a block of wood. We use cockfighting as an alibi to cover what we do inside. Behind the curtain, all the macho guys are giving a wink to Hispanic brown eyes.
Saturday night at the cockfight. Who cares what gringos may be?
When you're subliterate in Latin, then barbaric is the way to be.
Cockfight.
Boy.
Who cares what gringos may be?
Incredible. When you're subliterate in Latin, then barbaric is the way to be.
I know exactly where they had the raid because I've driven on the Palmetto. You drive right by there. And, you know, haven't you ever seen the billboard? It's one of the factions put them up. It says, you can't beat our birds. Yeah, I've seen that. It's 13 to 1 at 560 QM. Here's a fax that says, do you think there's any correlation between Bush and Cheney taking office and the price of gas possibly reaching $2 to $3 a gallon?
Yes!
Of course. Is there any correlation? My God. It's like asking, is there a correlation between the fact you're getting soaked and it's pouring rain outside and you're, you know, standing there with your thing on? Secondly, there's nothing that ticks me off more than these ignorant jocks pointing to the sky upon catching a football during a basketball or ducking a basketball or even taking a crap. Yeah, pointing to the sky. Absolutely correct.
Yes!
But I commend the hockey players who are two professionals and no difference between a sporting event and a place of worship. Correct. And as far as Miami being a sports town, question mark, would you rather see being a ball being hit or a beach full of bikinis? There you go. That's what it's all. It's sun and fun. Do they have major league sports in Hawaii?
No.
They have major league sports in Vegas?
No.
See, this is a myth. This is a myth. Not that this would be a major league town in any other respect anyway, but just assuming it might be, you know. Politics are corrupt, the transportation sucks. But just assuming that in all other respects we were major league, which we're not. Well, why do you have to have professional sports? Well, the Dolphins were plenty for all of those other years. Why do we have to have more than that? Well, what's the point? Does it make, do more people come here because we have that?
No.
No way. Tourists go, don't come here to see ball games. And I'm not talking about snowbirds who are here anyway. They're a captive audience. Whatever is here, that's what they'll do. I'm talking about tourists. Tourists come here for the sun and for to get skin cancer. Stuff like that. See naked bodies on the beach. Now we're talking.
Ow!
Yeah. Very good point. Excellent facts. 177 votes on our marginal poll question today, which I again apologize for. But we had to keep it simple because Eric is in an eating frenzy today. And they ran out of food in Orlando. Huh? No, seriously, didn't you hear that? That's why he made up that story about coming down here for the seminar. I don't believe that for a second. They ran out of food at Steak and Shake, Crystal. Yeah, all of those places. And that's why he had to come down here, right in the middle of the week. So Eric is out there in the middle of a feeding frenzy. He's probably passed out surrounded by chicken bones somewhere in his car, so you have to excuse him. So we had to make a very simple poll question today so we could get it up. Do you think most Americans take responsibility for their own actions? Yes, 32. No, 145.
Oh!
That's the correct answer. No.
By the way, speaking of food,
yeah.
How come nobody's called about where the closest Sonic is to us?
Yeah, George made a good point about Sonic, and I think we've had calls about them before. I think when we were talking about chocolate malts.
Yeah. It was great.
Which I'm not having no chocolate malt, because although the last couple of days I finally... See... I don't want to get into the thing about the weight again, but when you start taking diuretics, you're only fooling yourself because you're peeing out. Because no matter what you say, water is 75% of your body, of your weight. So you can fool yourself by, like, you know, peeing up a storm by taking diuretics, which are very bad for your kidneys, I should point out. And then you get on the scale, hey, look at that. And, of course, you don't have as much time to eat anyway because you're busy peeing all day. Although, I guess in Eric's case, he could probably, you know, He could have a sandwich in one hand and in the other, if he could find it. The sandwich, that is, Eric. Here's Miami. I'm getting real good on that, you know? About a half a beat. Here's a mobile in Weston. Hello.
Hello, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, how you doing today?
Pretty good.
Great. Hey, about on those same lines as that Robert Steinbeck, I saw an article on Sunday about him, about those cops that had shot the young black man up on the roof.
Right.
And there's no witnesses or anything?
Mm-hmm.
At the end of his article, he got up there and he said, well, and now for all you young black people, you know, when a police officer says stop, stop, you know, put your arms in the position that they ask you to and everything.
Uh-huh.
You know, that's all good and well for his advice. But the thing that I always thought was, these people don't read the paper.
Well, maybe you ought to read it to them.
Oh, but they don't read.
How do you know that? They don't know black people read the paper?
Oh, I grew up around the Overtime area.
Yeah, and they don't read?
I'm a white man who grew up in a bad part of town.
Uh-huh.
And most of the people never picked up a paper.
Well, you better go back and start reading it to them. Okay, all you Spartans out there, when a cop says freeze, put your hands up in the air. Freeze and put your hands up in the air. Excellent point, sir. Very good. And by the way, 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. I got news for you, sir. Most of the white people don't read either. You'd be appalled to find out. When's the last time most of you read a book? Huh? And I'll come in here and read newspaper articles, and the only reason I do it is because I know that 99 9/10% of the audience never read it anyway, like the Robert Steinbeck piece this morning. Oh, and I did see the While You Were Gone. I saw the thing on MSNBC, the way he had several calls of the search for Satan. Did you ever see that? It's pretty good.
No.
Because it really rips the hell out of organized religion and talks about, you know, some interesting stuff, like the Magi. And the fact that they were in all this hocus-pocus and demons and stuff. And they were the ones who went to visit the baby Jesus in Bethlehem.
Zoroastrian priests.
And the fact that during those days, it was a very fierce battle for the faith of the populace out there, for the dummies. And there were hundreds of competing religions. So why not make up a good one? And then anybody didn't want to buy into it, well, you made them an offer. They couldn't refuse. Yeah, and they had a lot of stuff in there about the Crusades and the Inquisition and all of these things. It was pretty interesting. I'm sure the church didn't like it too much.
No.
And, of course, they had the Catholic priest on there saying, oh, yes, there is a devil, and if you deny him, and yada, yada, yada.
That the power of Christ compels you.
And on Friday, if you would have only been here Friday, if ever a place needed an exorcism, this place needed it on Friday.
That the power of Christ compels you.
Exactly. Oh, wait a minute.
That the power of Christ compels you. 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 The power of Christ compels you.
Oh, there we go.
The power of Christ compels you. The power of Christ compels you. The power of Christ compels you.
Okay, very good. Everything ought to be clear now. Uh-huh. Coast is clear. Air's not too good, but the coast is clear. 567-05. Oh, the coast is clear over there. You better tell Bob and Cheryl that when you stop by and see him after your thing at the Shell station or before it, that the
maybe
coast is clear.
They'll stop by and see me.
No audience.
On the way home.
They've blown off the audience. Somebody was telling me that they really sound like crap. I think it was Johnny Dark. 567-0560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon Wireless line. Here's a mobile in North Miami Beach. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, sir.
You know, I was listening on the radio. They were playing some of the testimony from the Nathaniel Brazill trial.
Yes.
And I don't know why they say that he's testifying, because he's not even talking. It's the lawyer doing all the talking. He just sits there telling the kid, okay, now, you had the safety on, right? And the kid goes, yeah.
Yeah.
And you didn't mean to kill anybody, right? Yeah. And you know that it's bad. You didn't ever kill anybody, right?
I saw plenty of it this morning. He talked plenty. He talked enough to show his true colors.
Yeah, from what I heard, it was like the lawyer was putting the words in his mouth, and the kid was just sitting there saying, yeah, no, yeah, no, yeah.
Well, that's the way jury trials work.
Well,
and most of the questions, they just want a yes or no answer. Have you ever seen Perry Mason, for crying out loud? Just a yes or a no.
What did you think of his testimony? Did you think he helped
I think his credibility on a scale of zero is minus 400.
Mm-hmm.
And they're doing the poll on the court TV. How many of you believe his testimony was 85% no and 15% yes?
That's not good for him.
No. Well, do you believe him?
No, of course. Everybody knows he meant to do it.
Well, there you go.
It's ridiculous.
And how can I'll ask one more time. How come we're still not hearing more about the dead teacher, who was a family man and a dedicated teacher and a young guy? How come we're not hearing more about him? They keep talking about wasting a life. There's a life that we wasted, and he's not coming back.
No, and that's the problem with prosecuting him as a juvenile. If he was found guilty as a juvenile at 18, we'd have to let him go.
Isn't that nice?
You know, what kind of sentence is that? He's going to go to jail for 6 years.
Yeah, then the next time he gets pissed off or somebody steals his tuba or whatever, he throws another water balloon, then he go out and blow somebody else away. I say put him away and let's protect the innocent people.
And in closing, have you noticed how the calls have gotten better since George came back?
Okay.
Okay.
They have? Wow. I really can't tell. Do I remember calls from one day to the next?
No.
No. Yeah, George attracts the great callers. Well, you do, it's just that they haven't gotten in yet. It's only been 25 years. We're still waiting for the good callers to start coming in.
Uh-huh.
You just mark my words. I'm telling you, you got to take 20, 30,000 calls, then you get a couple of good ones. He was okay. He was pretty. In fact, they have been okay today so far. Not as good as Eddie. Not that good, but they've been okay. 5670560, #560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. What are we going to do about Hank, you know? Boy, he really let me down. It must have been a tough week in Louisville. You know, anybody has to spend that many days in Louisville probably is a little bit off their feet anyway. But he sounded to me like he was really waffling and, what are we going to do and how are we going to build him a bomb? Nobody's going to go. It doesn't make any difference where you put it, what it looks like, what they're doing in there, unless it's strippers or something. Nobody's going to go, Fatso. It's not going to happen. He likes baseball. I like hockey. And this town, they couldn't support either one of them. We will support Pompano Park, though, because it's a fun place to go and because they're not asking for you to build them a place. That's right. We got simulcasting going on right now. Milford High Line is in action as we speak. Three-Old Harness Racing, 3 minutes till post time, 1 o'clock. Monticello, 8 minutes till 1:05 post time. Flamborough from Ontario, 3 o'clock. Nobody ever called and told me where Flamborough Downs is. Harrington Raceway, 5:45. Thoroughbreds from Hollywood and Bay Meadow at 6. Northfield from Cleveland and the Scioto Downs at 7:05. Dania High Line, 7:15. Windsor, 7:20. How's Marty Adler doing? Meadowland, 7:30. Cal Expo, 8:35. Maywood from Chicago, 8:40. Watch those Chicago races. Don't bet on them. Watch them. And, of course, live racing tonight and every Wednesday night, Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday, post time, 7:35. And you got your great buffet on a fourth-floor dining room in Pompano Park. You got...